What's up, guys? Welcome to the Cubicle Convos. To my left, I have Josh, and to my
What's
right,
up?
I have Vince.
What's up? What's up?
And Vince, so your first topic, it was about R. Kelly, right?
Yep.
Whoa, man. Slow down.
Slow down?
You're anxious.
Hey,
you
just,
feeling good?
You said you just wanted to start it, so we started
feeling
it, bro.
Good?
This is it. We
All
starting.
Right.
All right, go ahead
okay.
and play the clip, man.
I didn't know what to say after that, so.
We noticed. Roll the clip.
I admit I done made some mistakes, and I have some imperfect ways. That shit ain't right. How they gon' say I don't respect these women when all I've done is represent? Take my career and turn it upside down, cause you met I've got some girlfriends tonight.
Alright. So?
Yeah.
Yo, that's definitely a new clip.
Yeah, I didn't expect the double audio, but anyway.
I said that was in the video.
Yeah. Anyway, so I don't know if you guys have been more or less reading up on the whole R. Kelly situation on Twitter or what have you, but there's a lot of shit blowing up about R. Kelly, especially since, you know, the whole docuseries about him is like a 6-part series. I actually myself didn't watch it yet, but I just wanted to mention a lot of what's been going on. So, first off, he's been dropped from his label completely. If y'all didn't know that.
I did not know
sort
that.
Of. Sort not of. Not really, though.
Okay.
So.
Elaborate.
What is he like?
He was on Sony Music.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Sony has dropped him, but they still retain all the rights to his music.
Oh.
And there's also a clause in the drop that basically, there's like a weird thing where they can re-sign him also.
Mm-hmm.
So, some of the rumors are, is that they dropped him, but kept all his music so they can still make money off of his music. They didn't delete his discography or anything. Like, it's still very much part of Sony Music.
Yeah.
And that when it all dies down, that he might make a comeback of sorts.
Oh, come on.
So, they were not 100% sure on that. But yeah, they did drop what? Him, but they still own all of his music. They can still make money off his music.
Come on, man.
Like, especially the streams, which is where, like, right now his stream numbers are...
So, in hopes of a comeback, they're keeping his music, basically.
Yes.
Okay.
In theory. Like, that's the conspiracy theory about the whole situation. But, mm-hmm. I don't
that's
know, we gotta wait for time.
That's absolutely ridiculous. Okay, one, I didn't know that. Two, I'm assuming I'm not the only one, right? Obviously, this doesn't count for either one of you, but I'm assuming that, you know, there's a lot of people... Of course, we know there's a lot of people in his defense, right? He's a great mm-hmm. artist, all that other noise.
Yeah.
Obviously, that's not enough reason to defend this man, especially
sure,
with
sure.
the amount of accusations. and I am in no way of defending this man either, but I'm waiting for him to respond. Like, that was like a response, but it wasn't a real response for me or for anyone else.
100%.
Like, all that clip was just, and
that's
if
like
you haven't seen it, all that clip was just him sitting in a car playing a song that was like halfway like half-assing defending himself.
Cigar.
That cigar was pretty big, but
yeah,
it was like a half-ass defending himself type of thing.
I mean, yeah, like, can we talk about the fact that he literally said in that little clip, how are they gonna say I don't respect these women?
That's what I'm saying. Like,
bitch, what?
He's trying to defend himself.
Like, yes. Hello?
Is that song ever gonna get released?
No.
I highly doubt it.
At least not under Sony. He could probably release
Well, no,
it.
He could release it independently now because he's not part of Sony.
He
might be able to still release independent music.
He might. Or either that, he just did it real quick.
The problem is... Let's say he releases it. Where's it going to go up? Spotify's not letting him put it up there. Apple Music sure as shit ain't letting it go up on there.
SoundCloud?
You think SoundCloud would allow it to go up there?
I don't know.
I highly doubt R. Kelly would release his music on SoundCloud. Just to put that out there.
If you got
to
do what you got to do.
Say if that's the only place left.
Yeah, you got
to
do.
Well, I mean, I'm assuming he's not doing it to upload it and get plays. Like, that clip was enough for a lot of people. They just needed to see that clip. And I'm assuming it was enough for him. But what I'm waiting for, and I'm sure a lot of people are waiting for, is just for him to actually come out and fully defend himself. Because without that, it's like you could assume what you want. These accusations could, mm-hmm. they might as well be real at this point.
He hasn't said anything about the documentary
right.
series. He hasn't done anything. He's labeled out no defense, which is why I think a lot of people are like, oh, fuck. Like, yeah, He's guilty as a mug.
That's what I'm saying. And then the longer he waits, the more, like, you know, like he got dropped from his label. The label dropped him. A lot of artists are coming out and saying they're separating himself from him musically. They're separating himself from him as a person. Mm-hmm. Things like that. There's a lot of things ultimately messing with his money, ultimately messing with his image. And for him to not say anything about these things, it's just like, oh, like anyone can sit there and think, oh yeah, these are definitely true. Like, yeah. I just want him to, I'm not defending him. I'm just going to put that out there. I'm not defending him, but I want him to come out and say something, because if it's true, then it's true like that. And it's fucked completely.
Even if it is true, which I'm pretty sure it's true, to be fair.
Right.
And also not defending him.
Yeah.
But in all reality, like, he literally has said absolutely nothing about it.
That's
he's
what
not
I'm
really
saying.
Defended himself. He's basically letting the courts go. There's nothing we can prove to say that he did it.
That's because I feel like either way, if he comes out, he just feel like it's all going to be twisted around
and, yeah, and like
in his face.
If he comes out and goes, oh, I'm sorry,
that's not going to do shit. That's not enough.
Yeah, he can't apologize for it, because then they're like, oh, you definitely did it. Like, yeah, if you're apologizing for it, then we know you fucked up.
Exactly.
Right.
But if he comes out and he denies it, he could get more backlash for it. They're like, oh, you're just trying to cover your own ass.
There's no point in him denying it at this point. It's too late.
But that's why he's not probably not going to say shit, because no matter what he does or say, it's just going to be thrown right back in his face. He's at a point where he just has to let it play out until either it dies down or till he either gets charged with something.
He's gonna wait till it dies down before he does anything.
This type of thing doesn't just die down. It's bigger than just his music. Like,
oh, it is, but that's definitely probably what he's waiting for.
But it does die down.
Sooner or later.
Because I mean, honestly,
for the public, it'll
die down. Now there still will be some professional artists that won't work with him for sure. He'll have that problem.
But in terms of
public perception, people don't seem to care about what went down with Chris Brown and Rihanna anymore.
True.
Or the like crazy shit that Chris Brown was doing.
If we're being
honest,
that shit died for at least from what I heard of it, died about 2-3 months ago.
Oh yeah, it died.
And then next you know, this R. Kelly thing is taking storm.
Yeah.
You know Chris, no offense to Chris Brown, but you know he's happy about that.
Oh, 100%. You know, because it got him ecstatic about that. He just got arrested, a few months ago for assault and battery or some crazy shit like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that was just at the end of the year. It was like a few months ago. He was again in trouble with the law. And like, bro, like that shit went down with his daughter and that pet monkey.
Mm-hmm.
Or like his pet monkey got taken, but it also allegedly wasn't his. It was his uncle's or something like that.
Yeah,
like,
I'm not too worried about his pet
monkey.
Wild.
That was weird.
No, literally nobody's like, oh, he's letting his daughter play with a pet monkey. Like, most kids are like, yo, the kid's got a fucking pet monkey. Like, I'm jealous. No, people are like, oh my God, that monkey could kill her. Bro, I've seen people let their kids play with pet snakes, too. Them shits could eat that little baby, bro.
That's
fuck
OD.
That's oh, no, you much. Can, as all those people say, you can domesticate a snake. You can do that. They're the friendliest creatures you'll ever meet once they're domesticated. Fucking lie.
Shit.
It's a fucking lie.
I call bullshit on that.
I did, too.
But yeah, that whole R. Kelly noise is, like I said, I'm just waiting for him to say something. And before it's too late, I guess. I mean,
nah, it's not going to happen.
I don't want to say too late, right? Because it's already like to the point where like these accusations are basically true.
Because they're too all. Late. It was too late all those years ago when he married Aaliyah.
Yeah.
At that point, it was too late.
Oh, yeah,
like,
for sure.
Like she was 15. Like there's
but
no
even,
like.
Even then, people were letting it go, and especially big name artists were letting it go only off the simple fact, or at least I believe in my head, only off the simple fact that I know. I mean, I don't know if you know, but like there was a lot of videos and things like that with producers and artists claiming like, oh man, like you know, Aaliyah, like she's amazing. She was 16, bro. Like she was 16, and like they mm-hmm. were just going off and saying like, you know. Oh man, I really wish I could marry Aaliyah. Like,
yep.
Like there was a.
There's a lot of going. Apparently, at one point, Jay-Z hollered at Aaliyah.
What? Oh, don't say that, man.
Allegedly, I don't remember who it was.
Don't know that.
But someone
that hurts my heart.
There was someone who came to R. Kelly's defense, and it was like, well, like these other rappers hollered at Aaliyah when him and her were having issues. But also, like even more to that point, like. Jay-Z and Beyonce started fucking with each other when she was 17.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
You didn't know about that?
No, he knows that.
No, yeah, I know about it. It's just... Well, first of all,
I mean, they weren't getting married, and like we don't know if they was really doing anything, but they was 100% talking to each other when they were 17.
There you go. I just wanted to. I'm glad you put that out.
I'm not gonna. Cool. I'm not gonna condemn Jay-Z because I fuck heavy with Jay-Z.
Okay, because you know Jay-Z is like my number one artist, and I hate to hear shit about bad. Like,
you know,
bad,
I'm not gonna accuse him of anything like that because there's no evidence of that. But they started talking.
Yeah. It's like your favorite ice cream, like tried to fuck with like underage kids, like chocolate ice cream, bro. Like if chocolate ice cream, like
chocolate ice cream, try to touch. A 15-year-old, that'd be fucked
up. I'd be a little blown. Like, like I like chocolate ice cream, but
what? Listen, I zoned out here for a second, and I come back, and you're talking about ice cream.
Just keep talking.
No, it was just an analogy. What?
Like that's a big thing, though. Especially like when you have someone that you look up to.
Yeah.
If they ever get into some shit, like I have a person's song lyrics tattooed on my arm. If they ever went through some shit. I'm fucked.
Yeah, basically.
That's gonna be a black sensor bar on my arm after that. You know what I'm saying? Like,
basically.
No, no, no.
Yeah, lean away. There you go. Bruh. Lean with it.
No, Neil.
Now lean back.
What? I'm good, bro. Just chill.
Okay. Right. But yeah, this whole R. Kelly thing has been interesting, especially with this docuseries. How much success it's garnered. And just to build off of this, there's a Michael Jackson documentary called Leaving Neverland that is premiering at Sundance this year.
So
once again, it's like chocolate ice cream, bro. No,
hold up. So I heard about this. I don't know much about it, and I'm pretty sure you're going to inform us. But I just got to say, we all know Michael Jackson did some fuck shit back in the day. And it comes down like he had a bad childhood. You know, that's no excuse, but the man was abused, didn't have a good home, you know, was forced into music, and then he just grew up around all this fame and fortune and all this fuck shit with other celebrities and fucking people coming in his house just to take pictures or videos of him. Yeah. Like, that shit gets you after a while, and it's like, he's been gone for what, more than a decade now? Like, he died in like 2009.
I think it was before that.
It was no, you're right. It was like 2009. School. It was like 2008, 2009 for sure, guaranteed.
Yeah. And it's just like I get it. He's done some bad stuff, and there's no excuse. But it just gets to a point where like, why are you gonna dig up his grave and stomp on it?
It's 2009.
Yep. Oh, like I said, nice.
But you June 25th. Why are you gonna dig up his grave and stomp on him? The man's already dead. We all know he did some messed up shit. Just let him stay dead. You know, we don't have to do this.
I think the reason why it's happening is with the way our society has changed. It has very much so become an attack on people in a weird way, especially people who are held in like high esteem.
Yeah,
and and for these accusations, which were made for a very long time, and like he went to court over them, and they all just kind of disappeared and got swept under the rug. That turned a lot of people the wrong way, especially the people that were involved. Like,
well, there was a lot of accusations about him with like kids and all that shit, right?
Is it fair to those kids that are older now?
Nope.
For it to not be brought to light just because he died?
I was actually gonna say exactly what he said.
That's a fair point. And I get it, I guess, but I don't know.
You like Michael Jackson, don't you?
No, I'm not even looking at it as like we talked about this not too long ago about how separating the artist from their music and then the person that they are. I get these kids should have the limelight they deserve to be like, look, this shit happened to me. This was messed up. This person was messed up. But, like, I don't know. The fact that, like, it just seems like we're just going back and digging shit up. I don't know how to feel about it.
I guess my thing is I completely understand what you're saying. And, like, I'm a Michael Jackson fan. I like his music. I think everybody likes his music.
Oh, yeah.
But when somebody was as talented as him or as famous as him or like Prince or some of these other huge artists, they're held to such a high level in the public's eye. They're almost like gods.
Yeah.
Like look at how people view Taylor Swift today. She could not do any wrong. So no. I think part of it is like, these are humans. You have to look at them as a human, and humans make mistakes. And for all these serious mistakes to just basically get thrown away and tossed aside is a problem. No matter how big and famous you are.
I think
that's why this R. Kelly docuseries was so big, such a big deal. I think that's why this Michael Jackson documentary is going to be such a big deal.
Yeah.
Because
like one of the people that is going to be in it is one of the former backup dancer, Wade Robson. accused Michael Jackson of raping him for 7 years, from the time he was 7 years old.
7 years?
From the time he was 7 years old to the time he was 14 years old.
Jesus Christ.
And this one, like, this one went a long way into the court system, too.
And he got away with it, didn't he? Or it was just
kind of disappeared. But a lot of people accuse this guy of lying about the whole thing, and that he was doing it for attention, and that there's no claims to it. Another big one that gets brought up is Macaulay Culkin. He was really, really, really good friends with Michael Jackson when he was a kid.
Like, are we talking Home Alone about?
Era. Yeah, Macaulay Culkin from Home Alone.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was friends with Michael Jackson when he was a kid.
Wasn't he on crack?
There was people from outside that situation that were like, seer. Not as weird. Yeah, Macaulay Culkin. Yeah, he went through a rough patch.
He's
yeah.
doing good now. He's doing great now. Great.
Yeah, he came out with a recent. He came out with a recent commercial actually, when I saw it, I was like, "Holy crap!" Like,
he looks way better now than he did.
Yeah, he looks healthy.
I'm proud of him.
It's dope
to see him go from like the kid from Home Alone to like a decent actor to then just look like pure shit to look now. I'm proud of that guy.
Have you heard what his name's about to be for the year of 2019?
He changing his name.
Meta
he's
World
changing
Peace.
His middle name. That's funny shit. But no, he's changing his middle name. Macaulay Culkin. Mm-hmm. His new name is going to be Macaulay Culkin. Culkin.
Huh?
Yep.
Are you fucking serious?
Is he still
changing
on crack?
His middle name.
To is he still
right,
on crack?
That's a valid question.
So he ran a Twitter poll of like, he's like, I'll change my middle name for a year. What do my fans want it to be changed to? And he basically ran a poll, and no. Macaulay Culkin won. So his name is going to be Macaulay Culkin Culkin.
No.
That's still his fault.
It's 100% his fault, and it's funny as hell.
No,
like,
why would he put
that? He put
that?
A poll out, but he chose the options.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
Yeah. It's that's great.
Wild. That's funny.
No, great.
It's so great. Dude, this is one of the times where the internet wins, and it wins in a good way. Like, I mean, this. Yeah. Remember Bodie McBoatface?
What?
Fuck yeah.
Nope.
I don't know who that is. There was some government that, I think it was the government, I don't remember who, but they ran a Twitter poll to name, or they ran an online poll to name their new boat.
No.
Which was going to go and explore the Arctic and like make groundbreaking discoveries. And the people voted for this boat to be named Bodie McBoatface.
That's a dope ass name.
Oh my God.
They were fucking pissed.
I would have been mad too.
Did they go with it?
Yeah, they ended up going with it. Because like the other options that garnered a lot of votes were like super fucked up too. Like someone wanted to name it Hitler. Ooh. Like all kinds of crazy shit like that. So Bodie McBoatface turned out to not be that bad of an option.
That's funny.
But yeah. So yeah, I'm curious to see where this, back to the topic we were actually talking about, I'm curious to see where this Michael Jackson documentary goes.
Neil.
I think it's, nice one. I think fault. It, I don't remember who's producing it. It might be like an HBO thing.
I don't know. I haven't even watched the R. Kelly documentary that came out.
It's kind of hard to, especially considering a lot of people don't have cable, like it's kind of hard to see. It's on Lifetime, so I mean.
Yeah, but I want to watch it, and I'm not going to lie, I will watch this Michael Jackson one, and I won't look at it as like Michael Jackson, one of my favorite artists. I'll probably just have to look at him as like just a person.
It'll be hard, only off the simple fact that, like you said, a lot of people can't like differentiate the two between musician and actual person, and only off the fact that like you, so a lot of people like dwell so deep into music, like they feel like they know the person, but you honestly don't know shit about them.
Hey, they stand.
Hey man, you can't stand too hard.
Yeah.
No, you can't be throwing your girlfriends in a trunk and driving over.
Right. Like,
I knew that shit was coming.
You can't stand so hard that you feel like you can defend them at any turn. They're still human beings. Like,
no, yeah, I feel that.
No matter what lyrics they have behind the music, no matter how good the music is, things like that. Like,
that's fair.
Shit happens.
I wanna talk about the word stand for a second.
Okay.
Because I think I'm glad. I don't know why. But I'm glad this got brought up in a weird way, right?
Oh, okay.
So stan generally means you're obsessed with someone, right? Like you're such a huge fan, you're obsessed, like you stan over people, right? Like your favorite rapper, you stan over them, right?
Yeah.
I think that word should have another definition.
What should be?
And I'm going to point to another Eminem song.
Oh boy.
As an evidence to change the definition to have a second one. Okay. So I don't know if you guys listened to Marshall Mathers LP 2.
I did. I actually enjoyed that album.
There's a song called Bad Guy.
Yes.
Bad Guy is a song portrayed by Matthew Michu, who is Stan's younger brother, who goes to kill Eminem.
Oh.
That's still standing. Like, even if you hate someone so much that you go through all this, you hate them this whole time, and all you do is talk shit about that person, that still means you're standing on
it. Oh, yeah. It is. Obsession,
like, just on a hating side of it.
Yeah.
I think, because that it's now with, like, a full word with definition, Merriam-Webster dictionary and everything. I think a second definition should be added to the word to include the opposite of it, like, you hate someone so much that you go through all these links. You're still obsessed with them. It's the same fucking thing.
Yeah,
for negative reasons.
Obsession isn't necessarily a positive word or negative.
No, but stan is generally seen as, like, a huge fan. Like, I think the flip side should be someone who just hates that person so much that they still track all they do.
Yeah. Do you want to segue into that Netflix?
It's a good chance to do that. So that new Netflix show You came out, I believe, last week, maybe the week before.
I think it was about 2 weeks ago. It came out.
Don't remember the air date. It seemed to be a slow burn, honestly. Like, I saw it come out on Netflix, and it was just kind of chill. And then, like, over the course of a week and a half is when it exploded, and everybody's like, you have to watch this show. It wasn't those, it came out, and people are like, everybody's like, watch it. It felt like it took a minute.
Yeah.
So it did. I watched it all the way through. And holy shit.
Hey, wait. Before you continue, I haven't seen it. I don't know who's going to watch this. Yeah, please don't.
I won't spoil it. Because it's really good. I highly recommend you watch it.
But
it is a very well-done take on stalking someone on social media, taking to the complete extreme.
This is what the description of the actual Netflix show itself says. It says, obsessed with an inspiring writer, a charming bookstore manager goes to extreme measures to insert himself into her life. You know, that is probably crazy. And from what I've heard, and I know you're probably going to talk about it, but from what I've heard, at least, it's just basically him using all forms of social media to, like, look her up, figure out who she is, all, like, this almost shit you wouldn't know unless you sat down and talked to her person to person. And what's crazy is, like, there's actually a couple people, for, like, an example, you know Millie Bobby Brown?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
She posted a video about how, like, oh, he's not crazy, he's not obsessive, he's just in love.
I thought that video was so funny.
Yeah. That's a problem.
No, that is a problem, and some people are bashing her, while at the same time, you've got to look at it, she's surrounded in a fuck industry.
I mean, yes, you know? She's young. How old is she?
She's only 14, 15 years old, so
she's pretty young, so she doesn't know what love is.
She doesn't know.
Even people in the 20s are not going to know. But the fact that she was watching that show and goes, yeah, this is acceptable behavior, that's a problem.
Honestly, that's
a problem. But it goes even deeper than looking into, like, her social media. Like, this dude, like, goes into
real life and, like, following her and shit type stuff. Does he do that?
Basically, yeah. And, like, I mean, he goes even into, like, her friend's social media to find stuff out about her.
That's right, yeah.
Like, it gets super deep. And, I mean, even after the first episode, you get a gut feeling that's, like, this is really fucked up and creepy and it's very unsettling. And you know that, like, people have probably dealt with this. Like, this is not based on a true story in any way, shape, or form. But I guarantee you something similar to this has happened to someone.
But you know what's also kind of wild about that is, like, at the same time, like the Millie Bobby Brown, for example, some people do look at it, like, not just the social media aspect, mm-hmm. as, like, that's just normal.
Yeah, and that's toxic, like, as hell.
It's flattering. Yeah. Like, oh, they care about me so much that they're watching everything. Like, no, that's fucked up.
No,
that's,
I don't want
toxic
you to
as fuck.
Yeah. Like, bro, look, if I go to the bathroom, I don't need you to know how big my shit was. You know what I'm saying? Like, you need some space.
Yeah,
that's toxic as hell.
I really need to watch it. It looked really good. I just haven't gotten around to it.
Yeah, I highly recommend.
Same.
You guys watch it.
Real quick, if you want to keep talking about it, but you know what's another crazy shit that's on Netflix as a Netflix original?
What's up?
That Black Mirror movie, interactive shit.
Dude.
No. We
don't give a fuck.
We sat. No. We sat.
Yo.
Here. Shit's fucking crazy, bro.
I've heard a lot of people talk about it, so I've heard about a lot of the different endings. So I don't feel the need to watch it.
If you ever decide to watch it, it's not like it's scary. Like, if you're gonna watch it, it's so fun, dude. Like, watch it with, like, a group of friends. It's dope as hell. Like, because it's so interactive. It's not like you don't have to just sit there and watch it. Like, you can, there's choices to make, and it's dope as hell. Yeah. Like,
and I'm glad it seems to do well, because I think Netflix is going to do that with more stuff, which I think
I really hope so.
But the crazy, you know what fucked me up about that show?
What?
Do you know what the Black Mirror is?
Isn't it about how like technology or something like that is starting to take over? No, no, weird
like,
shit like that.
Like literally, do you know what the Black Mirror is? Like, no, it's very literal. No, it's when the episode ends and you see your reflection in the TV or your phone or your iPad or your tablet. That's the Black Mirror. It's the reflection of your electronic device. And if that's not the dopest shit ever,
I'm blown. I did not know right? that. That's no fucking crazy.
That's so dope. Like, that's such a good name for that show once you realize what it means. But yeah.
But no, you've got to definitely check it out. Like, there's points in time where, like, so one, my favorite thing about it was the cuts. The cuts in it, like, most stuff like that where you have, like, a choice, where you pick a different path, mm-hmm. you can tell where it cuts. Never in the entire time we picked choices or anything like that, were you able to point out where that shit cut? It was such a smooth transition after you picked
your choice. Yeah, it was seamless.
It was almost like they did both takes at once and they somehow separate. Like, it's really good on Netflix.
Netflix is part. Only $1 billion company.
Yeah, but you know, they be releasing some garbage sometimes and then they come out with some other shit like this and it's like, it just still blows you away no matter what. You still got to give props where props is deserved. Number two is, even though you can make choices, let's say you fuck up or you don't like the ending, you can go back, but those choices you made previously, it recognizes that you did that and you're in like an alternate universe, so some of those choices are still affected in that universe. Mm-hmm. That's what really blew me away.
Yeah, it had like 12 different endings.
Yeah,
which I was not expecting that many. When I heard that they announced like they were going to do an interactive Black Mirror episode, I was like, oh, that'd be really cool. I'm sure to have like 4 or 5 endings. And then when it came out, like, people, there was a bunch of threads were like, oh, this is the ending I got. And someone was like, how the fuck did you even do that? Like, what? How'd you fuck up that bad to where, like, everybody and their cousin is locked in a cell? Like, what the fuck?
Well, yeah.
Like, 12 endings, like, that's actually really good and really impressive.
Yeah, for that. Watch it.
Honestly, would recommend. It just, if you want to do it with a group of friends, do. Our ending... spoilers to anybody who wouldn't.
No, don't do that. Don't spoil that shit.
This shit was good though, bro.
Don't spoil it though. All right, don't spoil that. It.
But anyway,
check it out.
Just to keep with the Netflix thing, since this is what we're talking about, new documentaries came out this weekend. One on Hulu, one on Netflix. I did not watch the Hulu one because I don't have Hulu, but I did watch the Netflix one, and they're both about the Fire Festival.
The greatest party that never happened.
The greatest Lord party that mercy. Never happened.
Read
the description for me.
So the description. Hey,
to stop shitting on Ja Rule, God damn it! It wasn't his fault. I just want to put that out there.
Look, I'm not gonna say anything.
So, the description to this documentary is: the Fire Festival was built as a luxury music experience on a posh private island, but it failed spectacularly in the hands of a cocky entrepreneur. And so, I'm not gonna lie, I only saw the trailer, and I heard about this way back when it happened, mm-hmm. but I don't know how old I was when this shit happened. But
this was like 2 years ago.
Yeah, it wasn't that.
Like,
it not that long ago?
It happened in 2017, and the promotion started in 2016.
I remember hearing about like people getting stuck on an island for like this crazy.
They starved those people,
and I was like, oh, okay. And it's fucked up. I didn't think anything about it, but like seeing this trailer, I was like, oh fuck, they did like some Survivor shit, but in real life. It wasn't no prank or some TV show. Like, they were legit, like, going crazy. Shit was being fucked. They didn't have any food. They couldn't get back, which was crazy. How did they get there in the first place?
It was private planes. They flew down on planes.
But then did the planes just like have a schedule to just not come back until a certain period of time?
Basically.
Yeah, and they were stuck on that island for that time.
I'm guessing they had no cell service.
They had some, because, I mean, people were live tweeting it, so there was internet and stuff, but there's just, like, it's hard to charter a plane out of the Bahamas. It's not like there's that many flying to these small islands. They were on Exuma, E-X-H-U-M-A, was the island they were on. But just, first and foremost, I want to start off with something when it comes to this.
Okay.
The concept of this, the idea of having a music festival on an island in the Bahamas or the Caribbean.
Is dope.
Or somewhere just on an island. And it's just you and music and a luxury experience. So basically, like, if they would have done it with what are essentially the equivalent of the rooms on a cruise ship, you know, you just got a nice little room. You're not going to be in a room that much. You're in the room to sleep or to fuck. Like, it doesn't, that's it.
Basically.
So the whole idea of doing this, it's a fantastic idea.
Oh, yeah.
The problem is, I'm going to talk about that at the end. I'm going to get back to the end. I'm going to recircle back to that. Just leaving that out there. That idea is a great idea.
Okay.
The execution of this idea.
Ew.
Was awful. Yeah. So first and foremost, they released that, they had a little teaser video come out where they like had basically what is a trailer, which was basically a bunch of dudes with super hot models. Like, who is it? Kendall Jenner was there.
Yeah.
Who the fuck else was there? Emily Ratajkowski, whatever her name is. I don't remember how to
pronounce the last name. Definitely not how you pronounce the last name, but I know who you're
talking
about.
It's something close to that. She was there. Bella Hadid was there. Like, it was just all these super famous models. Elsa Hosk was there. Victoria's Secret models. Like, yep. All these beautiful women were there. And they had this little teaser trailer of just them, like, hanging out and having fun on this island. And was like, it's going to be a bunch of music. It's just going to be a big party for 3 days, right?
Yeah.
Fucking cool. Sounds like a blast. Great advertising.
Yeah.
They then had 250 people at one time post a single photo that was just an orange tile.
What?
Yep. 250 people, 250 Instagram influencers posted an orange tile, and that was it. And everybody was like, what the fuck is this?
An orange tile.
It was an orange tile. Just literally an orange photo. That was fire.
What?
Fire Festival. Now, that even goes further away from what fire actually is. Because it didn't start as a music festival. Fire is an app or a website that helps you book celebrities for events.
What?
That's what it does. The Fire app itself is a fucking genius idea. Because it's like, let's make it easy to book celebrities for parties. So basically, you log on to it, they have their fee, you pay their fee, you go, this is where it's at, they show up. Which, you know, is cool. Like, sure, it makes it easy for you to book fucking Gigi Hadid to show up at your birthday party. Sure, whatever. Pay the fee, they show up. But to kind of like launch the brand, they were like, let's host the biggest music festival and the coolest music festival we've ever seen.
Sorry.
That app is probably fucked now.
I don't know. They
in terms of people like
Fire's
attempting
dead.
To use
Fire's
it.
Fire's dead.
Oh yeah, for sure.
But there's another app that's doing the same thing. Like the guys that started the app side of it are doing that app without the guy that fucked everything up. No, because the guy that fucked everything up is in prison.
Oh, okay. Cool.
So the app is kind of a cool idea, and they did the music festival basically for publicity for the app. So this music festival has all this stuff go down. They're selling tickets. Literally, a ticket was thousands of dollars.
This shit was What are you?
You getting?
Yeah,
you
I'm good.
You good?
I just needed to fix something.
It was crazy expensive. I mean, they had one option that was like $50,000. And like the 95% of this festival sold out in 48 hours. That's how big their marketing campaign was and how well it was done. That everything sold out in like 2 days. So it was like, it did really well initially. The problem was the initial island that they tried to buy for it was Pablo Escobar's island.
Yep.
Yeah. One of the stipulations of them using that island was you can't say Pablo Escobar's name. Because the guy who really owned the island was like, I don't want to be associated with drug cartels anymore. I want this island to be shown in a different light. So don't use his name. That first video they released used his name. So that dude was like, you know what? Fuck you. Can't use my island.
What?
So then they had to find a different island. And then they found a different island. And then they found a different island. And then they finally ended up on the island that they did it on. Which made sense because it actually had some infrastructure. The site that they ended up using for this festival was basically a housing development that never finished getting built.
Really?
And it was fucked up. Super hazardous. Like, nobody should have been there. It was awful. So anyway, they then decide to go, you know, we're going to put people in tents.
Yeah,
it's fucking Bahamas. It's hot.
Number one was a bad idea.
It's not a bad idea if they did it right. If these tents had air conditioning and, like, a way to close, sure, it'd be fine.
Yeah, but they didn't do that.
They used hurricane survival tents.
Oh, it's lit.
Yep. The day before people arrived, it rained.
Perfect.
So all the tents were fucked. All the mattresses were ruined. People were literally sleeping on wet mattresses. And they oversold the show.
I think I did see a video on that specifically.
350 people showed up with nowhere to sleep.
Yeah.
They were on an episode of Naked. What is it called? Naked and Survivor, some shit?
Basically. They got fucked.
Jesus Christ.
They were on Survivor, bro.
The initial caterer. Man. The initial caterer dropped out 2 weeks before it started, which is why they had that food problem. Because they only had $1 million to allocate to food, and the original caterer wanted $6 million.
$6 million?
Yeah. To cater for, well, it was like a few thousand people.
Yeah.
And I mean, it was supposed to be, it was like a chef and shit too, so it wasn't like cheap buffet food.
Yeah, it was supposed to be some top-notch shit.
Yeah, it turned into cheap shit, though, because they only had $1 million to use for food, which is that infamous cheese on bread with some greens in a styrofoam container. Yeah.
It looked like the defect food.
Yeah. it was nuts. It was definitely a problem. But it was just such a big disaster. Like, mm-hmm. Holy shit. It's awful. One of the worst things I've ever seen go down ever. And this documentary does a really good job of giving you just facts. Because the Hulu one allegedly, mm-hmm. there was some shade thrown between Hulu and Netflix this weekend because, grab me something to add. There was some shade thrown between Hulu and Netflix this weekend because they both released fire documentaries the same weekend. The one that Hulu did, God damn, Colin. the Hulu one allegedly, we don't know for sure because we'll never know, but allegedly paid the guy who fucked everything up. His name's escaping right now. I don't remember his name.
Okay, so about that, just a quick side note. Like, I'm sure obviously I need to watch it myself, both of them. I'm assuming what you're saying is that one, being Hulu, paid off the dude, or rather, the dude paid off Hulu to make the docuseries, and so, kind of, it was kind of more or less in his defense, I'm assuming.
So, the Hulu one, Hulu paid him $250,000 to appear, so they basically directly interviewed him. The Netflix one interviewed people around it.
Okay, so it was one side of the story versus the other.
Basically.
So, like, about that, so, like, and this is, about that, like, I know Ja Rule, you know, he made a series of tweets specifically talking about the Fyre Festival, and it's, like, for a long time, people were blaming him for the whole situation, or at least his part in it, I guess you can say. Yeah. Obviously, it's not his fault, or at least I think it wasn't his fault.
He was basically an innocent bystander. If you watch this documentary, his name was attached to the Fyre app.
Right.
Which then led into the festival, and then he was around for the promo shoot for the festival, and that was it.
Right, but
he was in, like, the promo videos.
People are so quickly to blame him for a lot of the noise, yeah. Or at least before the docuseries, there was a lot of people blaming him for the noise about it.
Because his name was attached to it, like, well, Ja Rule told me it was going to be fun. Yeah. Do you remember that clip that went around of that one dude just yelling for Ja Rule? I don't remember where it was.
I think so.
There was the one dude, he was just yelling, like, where's Ja Rule? Like, out the crowd somewhere. Like, what the fuck? Yeah.
No. If you haven't seen it, definitely go watch it. I haven't seen it myself, but
the Netflix one is really good.
Yeah. Stop blaming Ja Rule. Just go watch the damn series.
And it goes really into detail of, like, exactly where it fucked up. Like, bro, the one guy, his name is Andy. He was the one that was basically brought on to try to fix everything after they realized that they kind of fucked it up. And at one point, they had this water that was flown into the island that was stuck at customs. And it was Evian water. E-V-I-A-N. Mm-hmm. Evian, I don't remember. Whatever. It was stuck at customs. Homeboy called Andy and was like, yo, go to customs, meet with the head of customs, suck his dick, get the water released.
Hold up, what?
Yup.
No, like...
100. That's what homeboy told him to go do.
Wait. I'm assuming the suck your dick part was like...
Literally.
Oh, it was literally. Okay.
Like, literally. Yeah.
Okay.
Dude shows up and talks with the head of customs. And head of customs is like, look, as long as you promise that when people start getting paid, I get paid first, you can have the water. So he didn't have to suck his dick.
That's messed up.
That's dope. That's dope that he didn't have to do that.
It's great, because that's super fucked up. So he literally called the guy that was working for him and was like, yo, go do this to get the water. Like, nah, bro. Nope.
Yeah.
It was wild. Yeah. I highly recommend watching it, because it is very well done documentary. I enjoyed it thoroughly. I watched it today, actually.
Bet. I might have to check that out for real.
I do want to watch the Hulu one, because after watching it, the other guy... The guy that ruined everything, the entrepreneur, mm-hmm. I can't remember his fucking name, but I don't think when he started the whole Fyre Festival thing, I don't think he intended to fraud all these people and promise all these things that didn't come true. I do think he was serious about wanting to put on this festival and had no intention of just stealing money from all these people.
So what the fuck happened then?
It got out of hand, and they kept making more and more promises. But where it became a problem was when he was lying to investors. Like, they told... He apparently told some investors that he booked Drake for $100,000.
which is obviously not true.
Not true at all. He lied about how much money they were bringing in type of stuff. So I don't think in that situation he initially started out trying to rip people off other than investors. The problem is when he was out on bail, he was literally stealing money from people. Like he straight up was like selling VIP Grammy tickets for people for $20,000 that didn't exist just to get their money. Mm. And that's why he ended up going to prison for 6 years.
Jesus Christ. Yeah, only I'm definitely going to take the time to watch.
That's only six? I feel like it deserves more.
Six years.
That's just me.
He does have a permanent ban from being any type of officer for a company. So he can't be a CFO, a CEO, a COO at all. He cannot do that.
Oh, well, there goes his entrepreneur anything.
Yep. Yeah, but a lot of people are saying don't be surprised in 10 years if you hear his name again behind some other venture.
So, oh, yeah.
So we'll see. Because he does seem to be a smart dude. Like, the what he did before Fyre Festival was basically a credit card for millennials. It was, like, this exclusive credit card that you had to be approved to get into. And, like, the credit card was made out of stainless steel, and it was black. And it was a really good idea, really cool idea. It made him a lot of money. And then people were like, yeah, I'm going to buy into it with you. Like, I'm all about it. Mm. And which led to Fyre and then this disaster of a music festival.
Okay. I'm sure he's not too worried about making any kind of business after.
Oh, he but might.
Just to bring it full circle, it's what I was mentioning before about this idea.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I think it could still be done. Oh. I just think now.
Correctly.
Yes.
If you do it correctly and you do it over time and you do it at like a slow burn of like, okay, this year we'll get plumbing built on this island. This year we'll get electricity built. This year we'll get internet.
You have to be able to build their trust.
You have to do it in stages. They literally tried to do this whole festival in like 4 to 6 months. Yeah. And at some points they were literally trying to do things with 2 weeks left. Like the whole catering, the food situation, mm-hmm. that was like 2 weeks when that got fucked.
Yeah.
So if you actually did this and you did it right and you did it over the course of like a couple years to get everything built and prepared, yeah, this music festival could probably dethrone Coachella. 100%.
Ooh. Oh, yeah. 100%.
Because here's the thing. When this music festival got announced, there were sponsors for Coachella that called their agencies and were like, how can we pull out of Coachella to get in with Fyre Festival? People already wanted to leave based off that idea before it even was solidified.
I actually want it to still get done.
I do, too.
Correctly, and you obviously have to... You
know what I'm saying? Anybody from Wall Street listening, hit us up.
I don't think it's...
I got some ideas.
I don't think it's going to happen until we're, like, at least... a good amount older
because, until I'm rich.
Especially since this documentary came out. Nobody's gonna fuck with that. No one's gonna fuck with that.
Cash in my pocket. I can knock this out. Real talk. I can make.
But
this
about happen. Okay. about them doing it in stages, like, and just as I don't want to continue this topic for any longer. But as far as them doing it in stages, like, other than you know taking their time to do it and making sure that it's done correctly, you want to be able to build people's trust back,
mm-hmm.
like.
Because the islands, so the biggest problem with this whole thing was a lot of the people on the island that helped build all this stuff, they never got paid.
That's what I'm saying.
They're owed $250,000 right now. The lady whose restaurant basically like tried to help, she had to dip into $50,000 of her own savings to pay people that helped her make the food that they got stuck with forcing to make.
Oh, man.
It's like a lot, the islands who got screwed over a lot. So in order to bring this idea up to someone down there and go, hey, I have this idea and I'd like to host it at your island, I don't think it'll ever happen. I think it will have to be like you're doing it on a private island.
Yeah.
And then you'll have to start from scratch, like to build all this infrastructure.
But, you know, since we're still on the topic of Netflix, you know, the Bird Box?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's this thing
Never
called
saw it, though.
The Bird Box Challenge.
You haven't seen it yet?
No. Someone explained it to me. I was like, yeah, I'm good. Hey, you know MGK's in there?
Man, go watch the damn thing.
Yeah, at this point, I it's too late.
Shut up.
Everybody.
Shut your mouth. Don't you. No. You're not saying it.
I've heard so much about it that I don't feel the need to watch anymore. And like, I read the description. I was like, I don't think that's a movie for me.
The chick from Bird Box was so good.
Sandra Bullock.
Yeah, I think that's such a funny thing that someone tweeted out.
I'm still going to tell you to watch it. But something tells me you specifically won't like it, and only off the simple fact that there's so many holes in that movie.
Yeah,
like it's a decent movie, but there's a lot of holes.
I heard about that, which is why I was like, I'll pass because I don't want to watch this movie and then talk shit about it and then go, oh, you're a shitty person for not liking it. Like,
but you are a shitty person
for not liking it.
No, like,
or for not watching it.
No, I'm saying you are shitty. Like, if you,
oh, I'm just
you,
a shitty person in general.
Yes. I wasn't saying that. I mean, if the shoe fits, I wasn't saying that.
Oh,
I was just
saying if the shoe fits. All right, shoot your shot, Neil. Pop them bullets off, bro. What's up?
Hey,
all I'm saying is that you already know in your head that you're gonna talk shit about it.
No, I don't think I would. Honestly, if I just gotta sit through and watch it, but I just yeah.
Well, just watch it. Just watch it. Just anyway, put it on and like do something. I guess
I got you. But yeah, the challenge. You like cover your eyes and try to do mundane things.
There's just like a whole thing going around on Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube is a big like thing about it right now for some reason. Is people just put on the blindfold and try to go through their daily lives. And you know, if you just like walking down the street, I guess that's not too bad. But it comes to a point like if you start walking in the middle of the street doing
yeah,
that
it's
shit,
not it's not just mundane things.
But no, like, there's there's multiple stories. And like for example, I have a story up right now about a teenager who just like got dared to do the Bird Box challenge, and so she just like fucking puts on a blindfold while she's driving and
hits someone's car.
What the fuck?
There's multiple videos on YouTube of motorcyclists who are always cocky, period, but like they have blindfolds on while they're just, you know, cruising through daily life on their motorcycle. There's another story here about a truck driver who also crashed into a pole, and it's really funny because the police made a statement. They're like, yeah, we saw this shit coming. But now YouTube is trying to ban all this stuff and all that, and they're trying to get it off, and they don't know what to do. And I just think it's stupid. Like, what in your right mind? Like, I get maybe walking around the house, bumped into a wall,
or like trying to crack an egg into a pan or something like that.
Yeah.
I saw one where two dudes were like trying to play one-on-one basketball in their driveway. Like they had a hoop set up.
I did
and they
see
was
that.
To do it.
I thought that was funny. And
that
I thought
shit
was
funny.
That's
as hell.
Funny. But when it comes to when you're like I dare to do the Bird Box, and you're like, I'm driving. And,
yeah, like it's fucking stupid.
Like you fucking idiot. Then just wait till you get home, or just don't do it. You know, I don't know. And like it's getting a lot of bash right now, and I feel like, you know,
if you're putting someone else's health and life in danger, don't fucking do it.
Exactly.
Like, honestly. Like, don't do it.
Yeah, that's
true. I'm not surprised by any of this, in all honesty.
None at all.
Our society is stupid as shit. We're too sensitive as well.
It's not even
put that out there,
bro. We just dumb as fuck.
No, we dumb, and I'm going to put it out there. We sensitive. People out there are real sensitive about shit nowadays.
You better call someone a snowflake, because that's not allowed anymore.
Yeah, fuck it. I'll call anybody goddamn snowflake, bro. I don't give a fuck.
Actually, to segue into the sensitivity thing, okay. I don't know if you guys saw, this wasn't even a topic prior to, but now that he brings up the sensitivity, Family Guy is not able to do gay jokes anymore.
No.
Know you were going to say something. Right. I was waiting for you.
What kind of jokes?
They're not making any gay jokes. So hear me
period.
Out.
Like, no more.
Hear me out.
What about, like...
No.
Now, before you say anything, Burns, or Colin, be careful.
No. Fuck it. I'm not going to be careful. I'm not tiptoeing. Fuck that shit. Listen.
Our podcast is about to get canceled.
Hear me out. So, I saw a tweet about this, and I agree with this tweet 100%. When it came down to Family Guy, they roasted and made fun of everybody equally.
100%.
So, why...
Even God and Jesus.
Why all of a sudden...
And the Grim Reaper.
Why all of a sudden we can't make gay jokes? I don't get it. They made fun of everybody. And when it comes down to that, I feel like that's fair. If you're not gonna pick and choose what you can and can't make fun of, because next you know it, this show's gonna crash and burn. They're gonna be like, oh, you're not making fun of gay people? Don't make fun of white people. Oh, you're not making fun of white or gay people? Don't make fun of Asian people. Shit like that. Like, no. If you're gonna make fun of people,
sorry.
I know.
You say Asian people?
Yeah, I caught that.
I get a weird slur when
I had to call it out.
Yeah, no. But still, it's just, come on, man.
This is why South Park exists.
Yeah, but
they don't give a fuck.
Your Family Guy never gave a fuck, though. I don't understand why they're going back on their shit.
Them and The Simpsons. The Simpsons got rid of that one character recently. I can't remember his name because I don't watch The Simpsons. But they got rid of the one character.
What? Yeah.
The shop owner. What the fuck was his name? I don't remember what race
wasn't
he was.
Wasn't he like Indian?
Oh,
Indian?
Yeah.
I believe. Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, they got rid of him.
We're just look, I guess they're under, I get where you're like people may feel disrespected or something like that. Like I get it. Gays have worked really hard to get where they are now. Gays deserve all the respect that they really do, and that's so for real. That's a serious ass statement. Bro, my like my aunts had to move out of this state because Virginia didn't allow gay people to be married and own property together.
Yeah, they still don't.
They still don't, but there's states out there that do. So they moved to those states, and like, I get.
They've come a long way.
They have come a long way, but still, Family Guy was one of those shows where like they made fun of everyone equally, and it's like you shouldn't be offended over something that's literally a joke. That's where people can't get it. Like, they don't even make super offensive jokes. They just make quick jabs and call it a day.
Yeah, they never took the time to target anyone at any point. Like they made fun of everyone, and like they put everyone under an umbrella.
I'm just gonna put out there real quick. I'm sorry if I'm offended anybody, but this is just solely my opinion. 100%. This is just how I feel.
This has been a problem in comedy within the last 5 years, where a lot of people are getting backlash for saying jokes and are like, it's a joke. Comedy is the one area where you have to push boundaries to be funny. Like, that's historically, comedy's always been the one that has pushed boundaries to do
certain
things. That's
why people like it so much.
Right.
Because
and if it's done right, it can be funny.
Yeah.
Without being offensive.
Yeah, comedians say things that regular people just can't say.
Yeah, they're
publicly, generally, it's in all honesty.
The regular person's too scared to say, usually.
What is it? There's a comedian I watch. His name's Tom Segura.
Yeah, he's been in the news a couple times in the last few years of saying something.
Fucking hilarious. But one of the things he got backlash for, and in one of his specials he made fun of a little bit, was like a couple words you just can't say that you would just use on a daily basis. He was like, can't use that's gay anymore. He was like, unless it's really fucking gay. He was like, unless there's 10 guys in a line dicking each other down, then you can say that's gay. But like, you can't say it like that. He was like, you can't say retarded anymore. He was like, you wouldn't even say that about people. You would just like see someone would just say an idea, you'd be like, that's a retarded idea. And it's like,
yeah,
it's like you can't say shit like that anymore. There's people get so up and all about it, and it's like, why? We're just kind of kidding.
I feel like
it's a bit of a joke. You gotta chill out, you know.
I feel like, and I hope this doesn't happen, but like with the whole sensitivity thing, I feel like comedy and a lot of other things in relation to, or that might, I guess, more or less kind of like outgrow to other things, will just make everything so mundane, like, and boring almost.
Realistically, historically speaking, even within just the U.S., we're probably going to swing back here within the next 5 or so years to being more of a less sensitive thing, because something like this happened in the 90s as well.
Did it really?
Where everything, yeah, we went through a whole PC movement where everything had to be politically correct, and we're just in that
especially,
right now.
Especially with rap music. Oh,
you can tell.
Yeah.
Some of that shit.
Like, the word bitch was so, it was almost a sin in rap music.
I love you, bitch. I'm never gonna stop loving you, bitch.
Shit guitar in the background.
But in 90s hip-hop, the word bitch was like, if you said that,
you were like evil, like you were awful, like you hated women.
Okay.
Like,
no, I get it. Yeah.
It's like, more than likely, we're probably going to swing back soon. But also, I think the other issue we have right now is the vocal minority is very loud because of social media. Which, and the vocal minority is controlling a lot, and that's the minority. Like, I don't think the majority of people think Family Guy was fucked up for using gay jokes. No. I think that was a vocal minority, and vocal minorities hold a lot of power in today because you hear a lot of the vocal minority, and it seems like a lot. But it's because the majority of people go, oh, I'm probably in the majority on this. I don't need to say anything.
Yeah.
It's not that big a deal.
So all you hear is the minority.
Yeah. Right.
Well, I think even though you say like the local minority and all that, like, I might be translating this wrong because I'm just stupid, but there's even like the younger generation, like you said, has a hand on social media and all that. But there's
Gen Zers, Gen Zers.
Okay, and there's even
it's you.
What the fuck are you talking about, bro?
He's saying you're a Gen Zer.
There's the millennial generation, and then there's the Gen Zers. Technically, out of the three of us, you're the only Gen Zer. Me and Neil would both be millennials.
I don't fucking act like
it's alright. We're the ones blamed for the country being a piece of shit. So you're welcome.
Thank you.
We're doing such a great job.
Yeah, but go millennials. Yeah, go ahead. With your Gen Z, you have yourself, bro.
Shut up. I don't agree with any of that shit. These sensitive bitches. But What I was saying was, like, even younger people, you say they have a hand on social media, but even then, it seems like a lot of older people are starting, or even coming out, like, they've been offended by this shit the whole time, but they just never have said anything, and it's like, mm-hmm. I don't know. It's like, if you were bothered by it back then, why didn't you still try to say something?
That and platform even then, didn't exist.
Which is true. It's very true. But still, you know, they found other goddamn ways to do that shit.
Like,
know?
Think about it. 50 years ago, if you had a problem with something, you legitimately had to call your congressman. Oh, for How sure. many people do you know today that have the phone number to their goddamn congressman or House representative?
Yeah, that shit don't happen.
Like, nah. All right. Social media has made it so much easier to just go, I'll just tweet at this person and tell them. Which, I mean, they have people running their social media anyway. In fact, I think there might be, like, two politicians that don't have other people running their social media, and one of them's Trump and one of them's Ocasio Cortez. I think those are the only two people that actually run their social media. But
oh my god, we're not doing this.
No, I'm not talking about that.
Okay.
But
oh wait, keep going. Never mind. We'll segment to this in a minute.
Okay. Yeah, so I think it's just made it so much easier for people to get their voices heard with social media, which is a good thing. Don't get me wrong, it's a great thing. But the vocal minority can be loud.
That's when it comes down to, it can be a negative thing as well. It's a double-edged sword.
Sure. It is, for sure. Yeah, yeah.
For sure.
100%. Because not only do you get to hear all the great things you see, but you also get to see, like, fucking people be racist on social media, so.
Yeah.
Or the internet is a double-edged sword. Like, people are out here getting cyberbullied to the point where they're committing suicide. I think that's a fucking problem.
Okay, so real quick about that. I think that's fucked up, 100%. That, like, and then it's really fucked up when people go, oh, just walk away from your screen. Like, don't get me wrong.
That's not fair.
Yeah, that's an easy solution, sure. Yeah. But what happens when you walk back to the computer?
Exactly. Like, yes.
That's not even a fair thing.
That is, quote-unquote, the easy solution. But when it comes down to it, it's never that easy. That's like telling someone back in the day, way before the internet or anything like that, oh, just walk away from your bully. You're telling me that shit fucking worked? No.
That's when you get hit with a rock in the back of the head.
Yeah, not even that. That's when you get a fistful in the back of your head, bro.
Yeah, that's not fair. To tell someone to walk away from the phone or things like that.
Tyler Creator's tweet about cyberbullying fucking cracks me up.
But Tyler Creator's thing cracked me up, though, bro.
You mind if I read it?
Go ahead, yeah.
How the fuck is cyberbullying real? Nigga, just walk away from the screen. Like, nigga, close your eyes. Oh, my God.
Right there.
Yeah, just go to sleep.
That's funny.
Oh, it's a good thing I read it.
I do 100% take that as a joke, because Tyler the Creator is generally wild.
It is a joke, but like, bro, nowadays, if he tweeted that shit, it would not go well.
But if she got tweeted 3 days ago.
What the fuck you talking about? But still, like, for real, if that shit got tweeted not too long ago, like, let's say it was like 3 weeks ago.
Y'all must not remember the shit that Tyler the Creator went through.
What you mean?
Do you remember those Mountain Dew commercials that he directed? The two that actually got released?
Yeah, actually, I do.
So, it was quite a few years ago now. Tyler, the Creator, got picked up by Mountain Dew to direct some commercial for them. It was a series of commercials, and they were going to be, like, a story. The first one was this old lady in, like, basically a 7-Eleven, like, buying something, and this goat, like, knocks her out, like, bumps into her, and then, like, steals a Mountain Dew and leaves.
I remember that.
The second commercial was the old lady at a police station looking at a lineup, and it was a bunch of dudes standing in a lineup, and then the goat.
Uh-huh.
People took offense to the fact that all the dudes standing in the lineup were black males.
Oh, god damn it.
And there was this one, I don't remember what college this guy was a professor, but there was this one professor that came at it, like, hard. About how it was super racist and how it was fucked up. And Tyler, the Creator, was like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, we're both black men and you're tearing something I'm doing down? Like, those are all my friends. Like, they're in all my music videos. I do everything with them. Like, those are my friends. I'm trying to get them in the limelight. And you want to accuse me of being racist?
Yeah, that's true.
Like, it was super fucked up. And they could not air the rest of the commercials.
Nope.
Damn.
Yeah, that kind of sucks. Tyler, the Creator, went through some shit back then, because, I mean, that was a big opportunity for him to direct some commercials for a huge brand.
Yeah.
And for someone to tear it down like that, even though he's, like, trying to help his buddies out. Like, don't remember, I understand it. If it was a white dude directing, he put a bunch of black dudes in the lineup. Like, yeah, I can see this being kind of racist, especially if the guy had a little bit of a past of it. But for him to go, these are my fucking friends, and I'm trying to get them on TV so people can see their faces, basically shouting them out. Like, come on, dude. And, like, even when he announced this stuff, you still were, like, attacking him for it and saying how awful it was, how horrible it was. Yeah, like, yeah. Bro, obviously the guilty one was the fucking GOAT.
Okay, I'm going to play devil's advocate. You ready?
Yeah, yeah, go ahead, go ahead, go ahead.
So, I understand your point fully. You know, it's his friends.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, you, like, I'm pretty sure, I don't remember the commercial vividly, but I know he's close with, like, Taco and, what's the other, basically everyone from Wolfgang.
Yeah, it was like Frank Ocean. Wolfgang that weren't even, like, some of the rappers. It was literally just friends that he grew up with type of stuff.
Okay, regardless. So, me playing devil's advocate, I'm thinking, and you're 100% right. I'm only saying this for the sake of
for the other side. Yeah, yeah. Because, don't worry, I understand where the guy was coming from and the fact that it came off as racist. I completely understand that because it was all black.
Yeah, music. I was just going to say, like, it's a black director. He's putting his friends on the lineup and everything like that to get them some limelight. But wouldn't, like, if it was me, right? Isn't it safe to assume that people would look at it and be like, oh, this is racist? No matter the color of my skin, like, wouldn't it be safe to think that if you put this and air it on TV for everyone to see, like, multiple people are going to look at it and be like, this is a little odd?
I mean, sure, but, and I get that, but if you watch a police show and they go like, oh, the victim was a 5'10 white male, and they show a police lineup, it's going to be a bunch of dudes that are around 5'10 and are white.
So
it's like, even in the nature of police lineups are discriminatory to start with,
so
because the person's giving a description. But the problem was is that the description was, it's a goat and an animal and not a person, and it was a bunch of black males, and that's where the problem arises.
Okay.
So, like, just to kind of argue your devil's advocate point, it was like, that's where the problem was for a lot of people that were calling the commercials out.
But
okay, fair enough.
I can see where it can be a little racist. Like, I get it, but at the same time, this is just on, like, a director's standpoint, not more of the video itself, but...
I mean, if it's the director's standpoint, it's no way racist.
But no, but you're telling me...
No one should be racist.
You're telling me that if a white director did this with a bunch of white people, no one would bat an eye.
For good reason. I just want to put that out there. Like, there's a reason for that.
Yeah, but still, why does it matter? If Tyler, the Creator, did it with his black friends. And I get it. I 100% get where the guy was coming from. But that's stupid. Doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you do the same thing with a white director, with a bunch of white people. No one would bat an eye. Shit, if you did it with Tyler, the Creator, and he did it with a bunch of white people, no one would bat a fucking eye. Yeah. It's just stupid.
Very true.
People got to get that shit out of their mind, you know? He 100%, and they should have known that shit was not in any way, shape, or form to be racist. It was just meant to be a funny commercial and call it a day.
Yeah, and I wish we would have seen the rest of them, too, because I think the only two that aired were the first two. I don't think any of them, the third one may have aired. I don't 100% remember.
Maybe.
But I know for a fact the first two aired, and it was the second one that caused all the backlash. Which, it sucks, because that was a big break for Tyler, the Creator, because before Yonkers was out, and he won, what did he win, like a MTV award for Yonkers.
Yeah, like was a great video, by the way.
It was a great video. It was fucked up when he ate that cockroach, though.
Yeah,
like, fucking that, weird. But
I don't think he actually ate it.
That cockroach was in his fucking mouth.
I don't think he actually.
You're right. He may have put it in his mouth and then spit it out, but that cockroach was in his fucking mouth. They could have shit on his tongue.
That shit freaked me out when I saw it the first time.
That's a great video and a great song.
But
yeah, I think he won New Artist of the Year.
He did.
I think it's the award he won.
He did.
Look at us. Look at us. You're killing it.
I hate to switch up topics.
No, go for it.
I'm going to switch up topics to your expertise, of course.
Fuck.
But, of course, I'm bringing it up because I just got a couple texts about it from my family.
He pointed to me when he said expertise.
It's just your expertise. But I just wanted to point this out because we were going to talk about this anyway. Sports.
Yeah, yeah.
As of right now, it's Sunday. It's football.
Yeah.
And...
That's right. Your family's Patriots fans.
Family's a Patriots fan. The Patriots game was playing today.
Let me go to ESPN.
Apparently, shit got crazy.
Of course it did.
They went into overtime.
Oh.
And the Patriots won last minute.
Oh, yeah. They won
an overtime. So, for me, on my end, the Rams won their game. Well, the Rams might.
No, the Rams won. The Rams won in overtime.
They already won, right? Yeah.
Both games went to overtime.
That's crazy. They both went into overtime.
Ooh. Okay.
So, my Uncle Jason
about to bring us something else.
Is a huge Rams fan. And my dad is a fucking giant Patriots fan.
Can I be at your house to watch the Super Bowl?
I hope you guys know I'm gonna cancel every plans I have to go watch the Super Bowl with my dad and my uncle Jason.
Please let me go.
This shit's gonna be so much fucking fun.
Please let me go.
Please let me go.
No joke.
Dude, it's a big deal. I don't think you guys understand how big of a deal this is. So one,
hit it.
The Rams beat New Orleans in New Orleans.
That okay. is crazy, actually. Yeah.
That was the first time I was like, it might be since like 2006 or so. It's been a long time since the away team won in a conference championship. Okay?
You are too
the
hype.
The Patriots
right now.
I'm very excited about
but,
this.
So the Rams won in New Orleans. The Patriots beat the Chiefs in Kansas City.
Mm-hmm.
So two away teams won the conference championship. I honestly don't know when the last year that happened was. Like that could have been before we were born. Honestly, I do not recall the last time two away teams won the conference championship games in the same year. That's so true. First of all, that's a big deal. Second of all, the last time these two teams played in the Super Bowl was when it was the Rams with the greatest show on turf. You want to talk about one of the greatest NFL offenses of all time? It was the greatest show on turf. Are you kidding me? Marshall Faulk was a fucking beast back then. And they went into that game and they lost. And you want to know why allegedly they lost?
Why?
Because the Patriots cheated. That was one of the first goals of that era.
The whole football thing?
Yeah.
That was No. That's way before that.
That was
allegedly
like a couple years ago.
The Patriots had like recordings of the Rams practicing, so they knew all their signals and
that
all
was
this stuff before the game started.
That was a big thing back then. I remember
literally every Super Bowl the Patriots have won.
There's always been some conspiracy about them cheating.
For every Super Bowl the Patriots have won with Tom Brady at quarterback, there has always been a conspiracy behind it on how they were quote unquote cheating to win.
So
this is a very big deal for the Rams, and I love Sean McVay, former Redskins offensive coordinator, Redskins fan. I want to see him succeed. I'm happy he's over there. I'm glad. I want to see the Super Bowl. I'm actually excited.
I'm very excited, but I'm going to give my pointers real quick about one, the conspiracies. First things first, the one about the deflated footballs.
They cheated deliberately. Deliberately.
Okay. I'm not going to make my statement.
No, go ahead. Make your stupid comment. Make your comment. Make your comment, because I'm going to destroy it, and I want to hear what you say.
You are, and mine's kind of bullshit. So
go ahead, go for it.
Definitely going to debunk it.
Go for it.
So, one thing is from what I remember looking up, again, my memory's a little fuzzy, and I don't feel like looking it up right now, was that either way, the balls would be deflated, period, because they were going from room temperature to, it was fucking snowing, if I remember correctly, during the Super Bowl. Either way, that would deflate any ball.
So the problem was is that the balls were deflated in the game before that against the Colts as well.
Yep.
Also, just to, you know, to argue the crazy person side of it, because I love this argument.
No, I mean, you probably are right. You're probably right.
I don't necessarily believe this, but this is just one of the points I remember distinctly from this situation was people are like, when you use PEDs, performance enhancing drugs, you are deliberately cheating. To make yourself better at the sport and benefiting yourself.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
The distinction is that you're benefiting yourself. When you inject your ass with horse hormones to make yourself stronger and heal faster, you're not hurting anybody around you.
What the fuck?
That was a joke. They don't use horse hormones for
good, because I'm not into football like that. So for you to mention that, I'm thinking literal, like they sitting there sticking their ass with needles and shit.
They don't use steroids. They don't use horse hormones anymore. It's all IGH. Anyway. You benefit yourself. You're cheating to make yourself stronger.
Okay.
The deflated footballs not only benefited Brady, but hurt the opposing team. So one of the arguments was that deflating the footballs was more cheating than taking steroids. And if that's not like... I'm fully behind the fact that they cheated and they broke the rules and they shouldn't have done it. And like it was the situation surrounding it that was a problem. Where, like, Brady destroyed his phone to not give up text messages. Like, that was really fucking shady.
Wait, he did that?
Oh, yeah. Oh, that was a big deal.
I didn't hear about that. No way.
No. There was text messages between him and
the
equipment. Oh,
he's
guilty. 100%. No. They went 100%.
He's guilty, bro. Yeah, bro. No. I changed my mind. He's guilty, bro.
You know, they were cheated. Like, he destroyed his phone to not have to share text messages between him and the equipment manager saying, yeah, go ahead and do it. Like, they definitely cheated, but it wasn't the degree that people claim. Like, a few PSI is going to make the ball easier to grip and throw, sure. And yeah, Tom Brady's getting kind of old, so I'm sure it did help him a little bit.
Yeah.
But not to the degree where it would win him a Super Bowl.
No, I do think the deflated footballs got taken out of hand.
It was the thing that it was the Patriots was where it got caught. Yes. Because once again, they got caught in a cheating scandal. Because it's not the first time.
It's not.
Every time they win a Super Bowl,
I mean, I feel like something happens. I feel like a couple of our like cheating scandals might be false, but the with the deflated footballs, that shit probably did happen.
Y'all literally sent people to practice stadiums to take photos of play calls.
Yeah, that's just like fucked
that's fucked up.
Yeah, it's fucked up.
Like y'all literally won 3 Super Bowls doing that.
Go Pats! Anyway,
that was the Eagles. I know, that's my team. Yeah, y'all are great people.
Y'all are, dude. Philadelphia. Philadelphia did not hold a function for a fucking week.
No. Their fans, I love them. I've dealt with them a lot. Just growing up in D.C., you're surrounded by Cowboys and Eagles and Steelers and Patriots fans. It's like I've dealt with all these fans as a Redskins fan. Yeah, and they're like, Eagles fans are by far head and shoulders above everybody else for the terms of bullshit. Them and the Bills are probably close.
You're about to get some people mad.
Yeah. Bro, like, I'm not trying to because I love them.
If people are
like,
still...
I love them because the shit that they do is insane. Like, their stadium legitimately had jail cells in it at one point because at home they were doing crazy shit that they had to be locked up.
Yeah.
Like, are you fucking kidding me, bro? Like,
I didn't know that.
Yeah, they were.
Yeah, Lincoln Field had cells underneath it to put people in when they was getting too wild at games. Bro, they literally put batteries and snowballs and threw them at opposing players. Like, are you serious?
What the fuck?
Yeah. Santa, you know, holiday season come around, the football teams usually bring Santa out to go around, right? It's cool for the kids.
Yeah.
Nah, Eagles fans threw snowballs at Santa, bro.
R.I.P. Santa.
Like, that's fucked up.
So, I had to cut this short. We're like a solid hour plus in.
Yeah.
So this is good. This is good. But I don't want to keep going on, but I do want to do something real quick since we are on sports. I do want us to give our predictions for the Super Bowl.
I'm down for that.
You can't ask me that.
I'll do that.
I'll do it.
So
I'll do it. I'm very excited.
So we have the Rams and Patriots playing at, I believe, what is Atlanta's new stadium, which I also believe is still Mercedes-Benz Stadium. Coolest fucking dome. Well, okay, the second coolest fucking dome in the NFL. The way the roof works is badass as fuck, but Minnesota's is still a lot cooler because they're like whole outside's fucking glass, and they use real grass, and they use trucks to tow their field out from underneath the stadium.
Josh,
so they
you
can
know
water
too much.
It.
You know way too
bro,
much.
Bro, it's so fucking cool, bro. The stadium is so dope. But yeah, so like Minnesota still uses real grass in a dome because
these
they tow it out from underneath. Shut the
get
fuck
back
up.
On topic.
Anyway, back. So it's in Atlanta. Realistically speaking, I believe that's probably closer to St. Louis than New England and Boston. I'm not 100% sure, but
I think it is.
Either way, it's still going to be a big turnout from both fans because it's like even distance. I think we're going to see a big turnout for both teams. I think the Rams win 35-27.
Oh, you think it's that big?
Yes.
Okay.
I have faith in my boy McVay.
This is where, for me at least, becomes difficult because this is family shit
right
here.
I can't wait to hear how the Patriots cheat this
year. Be careful what your answer is.
Oh, bro, I'm so excited.
You're gonna go with your dad or your aunt.
Wait, I will take off that fucking night to just watch the Super Bowl with my family. I'll fucking do it.
I wanna.
Well, I just want to know what your predictions are considering your family is like.
So here's the thing: is I haven't kept up with football too much this year, but 100% what I do know is the Rams have been fucking killing it this year.
Mm-hmm.
The Rams
13-3. They're now 15-3.
Yeah, they're fucking doing fantastic. This is the best I've seen them since I've known my uncle Jason. Like he's been fans of them since he was a kid, but this is the best that I've at least seen.
This is the best they've been since the early 2000s,
yeah,
when the greatest show on turf ended.
So I love the Patriots because, you know, born and raised, my dad, he did that, brainwashed me, and my gut wants to say the Rams, but my brain is like, no, you gotta go for the Patriots. So if we're being honest, I feel like it's gonna be a fucking history. It's gonna be a history of a game.
Give us the score. What's the score? Who's winning? You said you want to make predictions. I made mine.
Oh, man.
35-27 Rams win.
I don't think it's going to be that high.
I bet Jared Goff throws for 323 yards with two touchdowns and one interception, and Todd Gurley's going to rush for about 87 yards.
I'm not going that deep.
A touchdown or two. C.J. Anderson is probably going to have 42, 44 yards.
I'm not going that deep, fam.
Nah, bro. We out here making predictions, bro. Listen. I'm betting it's a spread. Is the coin toss going to be heads or tails, motherfucker?
You guys want to... Tails! Y'all want to bet on this? That's
a good pick.
Y'all want to bet on this?
No. I can't bet on this shit. I don't have money, but also it's family.
Okay, fair.
But, I'll bet on the spread.
Oh, don't. You can't ask me to bet. I don't know shit about football.
So, honestly... I want to say the Patriots will win, but...
Give us a score.
I will go with the Rams. I'm going to say Rams will win probably 26-27 to probably 20.
So you're going 27-20.
Yeah, 100%.
Okay. Rams up by a touchdown for basically both of us. Okay.
Yeah, because that's always what happens with us. It's okay. If an opposing team gets that touchdown in that last quarter, it just seems like... we just can't do it now.
Tom Brady's great in the last 2 minutes of a game.
He is, but this past season, he's been choking.
It's because he's old.
Yeah, he is. He's showing it. Yeah.
He's honestly losing it.
So that's what I'm saying. If the Rams, the fourth quarter, get that last touchdown, 27-20.
I'd like to point out.
We will choke.
You guys?
Yeah, we got. If we get beat by the Rams.
I hope you do.
Our career is over.
No, it's not. Bill Belichick's still Bill Belichick. Tom Brady's still Tom Brady.
But we'll never hear the end of it. We'll never hear the end of it.
Y'all fucked up because y'all traded. Yeah. Jimmy Garoppolo away, and that guy was your future. And if you would have kept him when Tom Brady left, you'd still be in good shape. But Tom Brady had to be whatever. Number I'm not going to go into that.
Number one.
Anyway, but can we move on?
So let's move on.
You know what I'm going to talk about? Let's talk about music. I think we should start with the new albums first.
Okay, that's fair. Go.
The Wizard by Future.
Great album.
Listen,
I felt like it was okay. It felt like a Future album.
This is my opinion.
It was great in Future standards.
It was just
think it was great in Future. See, I think it was okay in Future standards.
If we're talking about album wise, it's just okay. If we're talking about Future, it's just another album. I don't think there's anything to go home. There's no like, oh, I'll listen to it on a daily basis. I can go back and listen to it multiple times and hear something different every time. I listened to it twice. I heard what I needed to hear.
And there
wasn't bad.
There wasn't a standout song for me either.
No, it was just a Future album.
You know?
I guess for me individually, a standout song would be Crushed Up, but ultimately I have to agree it wasn't like a 56 Nights or anything like that. Or DS2 or anything like that. Like, no, you're right. It wasn't a standout album. It was a Future album. It was still a good album because Future.
Yeah.
It
felt like songs that he had left over to throw on a
project. Oh yeah, like throwaway songs.
I feel like there's songs that missed out on other albums, or he's got another album coming out later this year that these were just songs that he knew wasn't gonna make the cut.
He put a lot of songs on there though.
It was 20, and that's why I feel like that, because 20 songs, like most albums today for a lot of these people, 12 to 15. Like Keith dropped his album, which was 12, which was awful. There was like one song on there that I really liked, and it was a song with Gucci. Outside of that, like, that album's just not great. YNW Melly's tracks got like two or three songs out of the 12 or 15 it had. Honestly, wouldn't even recommend it.
Logic dropped a single.
I'm not a Logic fan.
I don't know if you guys...
I didn't listen to it.
Neither of y'all are Logic fans.
Yeah, you know I'm not. I don't listen to Logic.
I don't need to listen to rap for homeboy to preach at me.
It wasn't a preach single, though. He was just spitting bars. It was a good song. That's all I got to really say about it. I enjoyed it. I'll check it out later. It's called Keanu Reeves.
What the fuck?
Yeah, the album cover's fucking dope. It's like a skull.
So it's not Keanu Reeves?
It's just got a skull with like fucking wires plugged into the back of
it. Should have been a vampire.
What's the song name?
Keanu Reeves.
Isn't that
an actor?
Yeah. Okay, cool.
Or, and you know, the Matrix.
I think the whole thing of it is that he murders the track, quote unquote. I think that's what he's trying to get. And he did a decent job. I think it's definitely Logic's flow, which he has a really great flow. He knows how to do it. I think I might give
Logic a chance.
Honestly,
I've listened to a lot of his music.
I've been shitting on him in a lot of biracial jokes.
I was never one to shit on him. His music was never towards me, and a lot of his music is very fucking preachy.
If you don't want any preachy shit, this is my opinion, and I understand the preachy shit gets a little annoying after a while. Listen to Bobby Tarantino.
You know him? You know who propelled his career? And this is going to sound wild, but you know who really helped propel Logic's career?
Who?
FaZe Clan.
Who?
FaZe. The Sniping Clan.
What?
Oh! Yeah. Because back in the day...
That's
how he got video famous. Games. Yeah.
Because he allowed FaZe Clan to use his songs and their YouTube videos. That's, and their YouTube videos were pulling out millions of views every time they released one.
That's no joke. I remember that. He talked about that.
Even now, today, like, he'll show up at the FaZe house that they have and just chill out with them. He gives some shout-outs
on the radio channel every once in a while when they'll ask him, like, you know, how this all start. And he's like, hey, shout-out to them. Mm-hmm. They got my starting. No joke.
Yeah, yeah. They got his music in front of people, which is wild.
But. It's dope for him to actually, like, admit that,
too. Oh, he's humble. He's humble as fuck about it.
Yeah, no, he seems like a good person, which I think is part of the problem is, like, he just preaches a lot in his rap. Like, he's literally got one song that's all about quitting smoking cigarettes. And he's just, like, preaching about how you should quit
smoking. So does Ugly God.
Stop smoking black and mouths.
But I promise you, it's not preachy. It's a dope song.
It's just funny. It's just...
I love that song.
Stop smoking black and mouths. This shit nasty. Some
I just think it's like wild. This shit funny. Like, a lot of his music comes off as preachy, and I don't listen to hip-hop to 100% preach that. If does that make sense?
No,
it makes perfect sense.
There's a couple of songs I do enjoy that are a little preachy, but if you don't want no preachy shit, you just want good flow, good bars. Bobby Tarantino's good like that. The single 44 bars, 44 more, those are both just straight-up songs where he just gets on the track and just spits shit. He has no preaching, nothing like that.
Have you guys heard what, like, some of the other criticism is against Logic?
No.
Biracial?
So you know, like, how a lot of his music about him being biracial? And people are like... Bro, you look like a white dude.
Oh, okay.
Like, how are you rapping about being biracial?
How many times have I
talked
to you about
that?
Yeah,
so...
Nobody knows.
I think that's so funny.
I think it's hilarious, too. Like, a lot of people call him out on that, too. Like, how do you... What? Like, you look like a white dude. Like, nobody knows you're biracial unless you bring it up.
But, I mean, I think it's weird that on the track... He raps about it. I mean, I get if in person.
He raps about it a lot.
He does. Well, like, that's because I feel like...
His whole last album was about that.
I feel like...
like, the whole album.
This is just me.
How do you make a whole album about being biracial?
But...
I'm fucking dead.
What are you talking about? You talking about Young Sinatra? Because that shit was good. That didn't have a lot of...
I heard it was really good.
Young Sinatra... I heard it was good, but... All of his Young Sinatra shit, like, back when he was, like, just on mixtapes, like, on Daft Punk. Or was that right?
Daft Punk.
The two DJs that have been around since like 1945.
No. What's that one?
It's a little far back, but
Dat Piff.
I get you.
You know, Dat Piff.
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, datpiff.com. That's more close to Dat Punk.
Shut up. Anyway,
bro, I remember when you download a song off of LimeWire, and that should be like Dat Piff exclusive.
But no,
hey, they played this shit like at the beginning of the song, like halfway through the song. You're Dat Piff exclusive, like, bro. Like, chill out, bro. Like, you
know,
I get it.
You know how annoying that was trying to download music and you always middle, have that. Yes, yeah. Bro. Oh my god.
All of Bow Wow's music had that Dat Piff shit, bro. I'm telling you,
Bow Wow.
But
I miss LimeWire.
I don't. Shit was virus central. Although the great thing about LimeWire, and this is an era of music that I think a lot of people forget about. The LimeWire era was the era where there was Alvin and the Chipmunks remixes of every goddamn song on the planet.
I wanted to kill myself.
Bro,
oh my god,
there's an Alvin and the Chipmunks remix of Because I Got High.
Yep.
And it's fucking phenomenal. It's like one of the ones that's actually enjoyable because it just sounds ridiculous. But yeah, we lived through that.
But to end on,
I can't wait to tell my grandkids about the Alvin and the Chipmunks songs.
Nope. We're not doing that.
But I have a whole CD and everything.
You have a gun?
I have a whole iPod.
You have a gun?
What?
Do you have a gun?
It's not here.
All right, cool.
It's not here.
But to end this Logic new single, pretty good. We recommend. You don't want no preachy shit. Listen to Bobby Tarantino 1 and 2. Maybe go listen back to his mixtapes with. They're called Young Sinatras. Those are really good. His one album, Welcome to Forever, is actually not that bad either. The first song. Literally called Welcome to Forever. I fucking love that song. It's really good. But all in all, not bad. But what I want to talk about,
I was about to say, I think we want to talk about the same person, because there was a new single that came out.
Seven Rings by Ariana Grande.
It's a new single.
Killing that shit, bro. She out here, bro.
Hey, he's kind of
looking at me.
That's my
face.
Bitch. All right.
You obviously a big Ariana Grande fan.
Listen, I loved Ariana Grande when she released her first goddamn single when she was on goddamn Victorious. I love that shit. People talk shit. Nah, I had that shit on my iPod. I still have that shit on my iPod, bro.
That's kind of far back. That's far back.
That shit was fire, bro. Now she releasing this die fire.
Die hard Ariana bro. Fan.
Apparently. You standing over Ariana?
Oh, I stand her when I saw her in Victorious. No joke. 100%.
Okay.
That's facts.
Can we just move on to the song?
Okay, so.
I feel uncomfortable.
But in all seriousness, Seven Rings was pretty fucking good.
I like it.
Almost died.
It'll be fun. I like it.
Yeah, we want to play any snippets? Yes, no, maybe.
I think we just talk about the lyrics.
Yeah. Where do you want to start
off? Hey, you know, yeah, play a little snippet of it.
Where do you want to start? A beginning, middle, end?
It's up to you. It's your topic, bro.
Well, yeah, it's not really my topic. He wants to talk about the lyrics.
I do want to talk about.
We all do. I have so much shit to say about this.
That's why I want to know where do you want to start.
Cue it from the beginning. Let it roll for a minute.
All right, we'll let it roll. Breakfast at Tiffany's and bottles of bubbles. Girls with tattoos who like getting in trouble. Lashes and diamonds, ATM machines. Buy myself all of my favorite things. Been through some bad shit, I should be a savage. Who would've thought it turned me to a savage? Rather be tied up with calls and not strings. Write my own checks like I write what I sing. Yeah.
Okay.
All right. I'm not gonna sit here and lie to myself, man. No. That's a good song.
It is. It is.
There's a lot of shit that I could talk about referring to the song, but it's not a bad song.
No, I like I said, I like it. Yeah. I like it. It's something that I could listen to. If someone puts it on in the car, I'm not gonna hit it. I'm not gonna talk shit about it.
Yeah.
I like it. I think. All right. First of all, shout out to The Sound of Music.
No, shout out to Soulja Boy.
Oh, we're gonna.
Okay, I'm talking about the initial part of the song.
We're not talking about Soulja Boy per se, but can we just say that?
Pretty Boy Swag.
Yeah, there
pretty
we go.
Boy,
I got screenshots.
Pretty
by the way,
Boy Swag.
If you want me to read it,
anyways.
I got screenshots from Soulja Boy.
I don't think we need it. Bro, he straight up said you a thief.
Oh, like, we don't need the screenshots. We don't need them.
No. Like, he straight up, literally, one of the tweets was, you a thief at Ariana Grande. Bro, yeah. I was like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
But I guess my problem with that, how many people have ripped off that flow
that's,
in the last 10 years? Like, I don't think she's the only one. I think it's kind of shady that you calling her out on it, but not anybody else.
Well, here's the thing. The timing was really, really bad in terms of Soulja Boy accusing her for that, only off the simple fact that, of course, there was a lot of interviews prior where Soulja Boy was like
accusing Drake of it.
And accusing Drake of going, like, you know, stealing bars from him, like literally stealing bars.
Yeah, like full lines. But Drake's been accused of that more than once now. He was accused by that of Soulja Boy and X.
Right, but then right after, it's like, okay, and then the song comes out, and it kind of sounds similar. Soulja Boy just
been in the news a lot the last 2 months. So.
Oh yeah, for sure, but. The timing, like I said, it was bad in terms of, like I said, the Soulja Boy and with her dropping that song and the timing, Soulja Boy had the perfect opportunity to attack Ariana Grande.
Oh, yeah.
Obviously, it wasn't needed. A lot of people go out of their way to I wouldn't even say steal the flow, but it's a common flow.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Especially with trap music. It's a very common flow in the trap world. Like, Walk It Like I Talk It by Migos, which was the biggest song arguably of the year last year.
Yeah.
That's that flow. Soulja Boy called Migos out on it though.
Exactly.
I think so.
And Migos didn't call Ariana Grande out on it.
I think it's ridiculous that
I don't think they have the time.
She just showed me.
I mean, that's true too. They wildin'.
Yeah.
I think it's ridiculous that what she just showed me was that both Soulja Boy and even 2 Chainz have called her out on it, and it's like,
and 2 Chainz got it from Soulja Boy.
You know it's just because I don't know. I feel like they're just like kind of mad that she's getting so big over this. Like, she's already been big period, but this shit blew up on day one. Every single she has released so far has been big on day one, and I feel like artists are looking at this and they're like, all right, what can I do to get into this? Okay. What can I do to get into this hype?
100%. I have a serious question. Okay. I have a serious question, and I haven't mentioned this question on either of you two even before when we kind of briefly talked about this off mic.
What's up?
Do you think this is cultural appropriation?
Ooh.
What
do you mean?
So cultural appropriation is generally somebody from outside a culture, in this case hip-hop, somebody who never grew up in hip-hop, somebody who's never rapped or done anything like that, uses it to boost their career, which right now hip-hop is a big thing in pop music.
Yeah.
It's what's killing the charts. Drake is at the top of the charts for sure.
Oh, yeah.
Do you think this is cultural appropriation?
Yes. 100%. No, yeah. I do.
I don't know.
Because and I see the argument from both sides. First and foremost, I see the argument from both sides. And just to argue against it to begin with, against the cultural appropriation begin with. The music industry right now is run by hip hop.
Yeah.
So everybody's doing it, not just her. For her to just kind of go and use a flow from a hip hop song, is she really biting into the hip hop culture to do that? Is she targeting people in who listen to hip hop to pull them in, or is she using hip hop to benefit her career even more? Like, is this song going to get her bigger than she was before?
No.
So that's argument against it being cultural appropriation.
To say that she's getting bigger than before, no.
Because I'm not of the song. That because, right. No. And that's generally when cultural appropriation is accused in a thing, it's when you're using it to make yourself bigger than before.
So, real quick, Amiya's going to be talking on this real quick. She got some tips she wants to say.
Okay. So
this is just in the topic of it possibly being a cultural appropriation. Okay. It's not based off of the fact that she's using, you know, like a hip-hop flow or anything like that. It's more what she's been getting backlash about on Twitter and stuff like that, especially has been more about the lyrics in the song.
Mm-hmm.
Coming a lot from usually like black female culture and stuff like that.
The line about the hair is a big thing right now.
Exactly, and she even posted on an Instagram story
about it. Yep, I'm glad you bring that up.
You like my hair? Gee, thanks. Just bought it. White women talking about their weaves is how we're going to solve racism. And she got a ton of backlash for that.
Yes, she did. Because that is super fucked up, and I was going to bring that up next. Yeah. So I'm glad you did.
Okay, cool.
She deleted that already, first and foremost. She literally posted that and deleted it within minutes.
It was like instantly people popped off.
I didn't hear you fully about the comment she made referring to it. Can someone just repeat it right quick?
Yeah, so what she said exactly was she said, she quoted the lyric where she was talking about it, and then she said, white women talking about their weaves is how we're going to solve racism.
Yeah, exactly. That post was a bad post.
That's
a
terrible
idea.
Yeah, and that in combination with the fact that she's already been getting backlash over the last couple of years about, you know, using more vernacular that's not common in Italian white women, and herself tanner becoming increasingly darker and stuff like that, to the point where people are shocked to find out that she's white.
That's tough.
In combination with the song is why a lot of people are saying that it's cultural appropriation and that perhaps it shouldn't be as big as it is.
That's tough.
Yeah, I was gonna bring that Instagram post up next.
Okay, let me just say this. I don't know if y'all notice, Ariana Grande is from Broward, like South Florida, Broward. That's literally where I'm from. So it's like, to say, I'm having a hard time saying that it is cultural appropriation. The only thing I can say, which is obviously, like, it's damn near a fact, that line and that comment, obviously it's touchy. It's something she probably shouldn't have said because she's getting a lot of backlash for it. That part in itself might be considered cultural appropriation, right? Yep. The song, if that's what you were asking about, the song itself, if she's using it to up herself, and would you consider it culture? I can't straight up say yes. Only off the simple fact that, like I said, I know she's from Broward. That doesn't really tell me whether or not she listens to that type of music or not. Mm-hmm. But I know or at least I'm assuming that she's grown up around that area. She's experienced and been around a lot of...
Yeah, it could be that that's the nature of the environment that she grew up in.
Right, which is all in fair. Like, if that's where you grew up and that's what you've learned since...
Since birth. Because, like, since for instance, birth, me and Colin are from Virginia. We're both from Virginia.
Right.
We're both completely different just because of where I grew up.
way different.
I mean, we get along, but yeah, the but shit like he says, I grew up never heard Son of It.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. So like, is it? Would you consider it cultural appropriation if you know or assume that from where she's from and that's she's been around that kind of thing?
Mm-hmm.
Would you consider it then a cultural appropriation for her to use that?
If that's the case, and you consider it cultural appropriation for her, just common term for people who use it as culture vultures. It's a right. common term
like
today.
If you,
you could accuse Eminem of being a culture vulture. You could accuse MGK.
Based on my theory?
No, not based on your theory. Okay. Just in general, like people who are in the same situation as her, where it's where they grew up.
Right.
Like you could accuse Eminem of it. You could accuse MGK of it. You could accuse Riff Raff of it. And Riff Raff actually caught a lot of flack at one point in time for being a culture vulture. Like he dealt with it a lot. You could accuse Post Malone of being a culture vulture. You could accuse Michael Rapaport of being a
Where's
culture vulture.
Where's Post Malone from?
Somewhere in the South. I don't recall.
Okay.
He's from the South, but.
Okay.
Yeah. Like there's a lot of famous white people who are in the hip hop and
but just
that
to take,
community.
Just to take my theory in hand, like if you think about it, Eminem, we've seen 8 Mile, like.
Yeah.
He's been around that from birth. So
just
because of the color of his skin from birth, you can't say.
Right. Like, would you consider, you know me, would you consider me a culture vulture? Like, you know the music I listen to. You know how I talk. That's what I'm saying. So, like, to argue for your point, if that's the nature of the environment she grew up in, that's the nature of the environment she grew up in. That's not being a culture vulture. That's what
exactly.
you know.
That's my point. So I can't say she's using it for culture. Like, and plus, to your point earlier, usually cultural appropriation within music, you would use it to up yourself into into another level
of success.
Of success, one. Two, also to put yourself in a space where you may or may not belong in.
Yes. A big example of cultural appropriation historically in the music industry, Elvis.
Whoa.
Yup.
Yeah.
How so?
Elvis stole a lot of his music from black men. There's one guy in particular, I don't remember his name, which is horrible of me to know that Elvis has done this and not remember the guy who's he stole from. But yeah, like Eminem even has a line in one of his songs. I don't remember the song. Is it My Name Is? I want to say it's My Name Is. Or no, it's The Real Slim Shady. He says, I'm the first person since Elvis to use black music so selfishly to make myself wealthy.
Mm. Now, we all know Eminem is a...
Eminem from the hood. Like, he from 8 Mile. Like, well, he's not...
Yeah. So, you can hear that line from him and be like, oh, that's just a joke.
Yeah,
especially
that's a
considering
joke.
Eminem's music, so...
Yeah. But, I mean, like, that's a fact about Elvis that he called out.
Yeah. So, to answer your question, no.
I don't think it is either. I just want to bring it up because I haven't seen it come up yet, but I kind of expect it to.
Okay, fair enough.
I do kind of expect to see some... Somewhere, especially after that rapper, is it Princess? Is her name Nokia?
Princess Nokia, yep.
After her comment about her whole thing, I kind of expect people to bring up the cultural appropriation debate. Maybe not mainstream, but I wouldn't shock me if you see it pop up on Twitter.
It might pop up on mainstream. It might get up there. If it gets enough, it will probably get up there, 100%. But
I mean that's fair. But I'm curious to see where this whole situation goes. I think the song, it has the potential to be a number one hit.
Oh,
honestly,
it's a
pretty solid song, especially with where the top 40 countdowns are right now.
It could have been a completely different song, and if we're being straight up, it's Ariana Grande, man.
Any song she releases as a single for an album, which we are to assume this and Thank You Next were the first two singles off her next studio album, they're going to be big deals.
Well, even then, like, every time she, ever since, I think maybe her second album, people finally started respecting her as an artist. Because before then, they're just like, you're just a chick from Victorious.
Until a kid show star.
Yeah, until she hit that point where she hit that, where people were like, oh, she can sing and she can write some lyrics. It wasn't until then where her singles finally were like hitting top charts. As soon as she started dropping singles, they almost every time they were number one. She is without a doubt almost hit number one at least once, either on the album or on a single.
You know it's wild, just to bring up number ones and albums.
Okay.
You know Katy Perry's first album
has
the most number one singles of any album of all time.
I mean, good for her.
That song has like 9 number ones on it.
Her last album was shit.
Okay. So I meant to pull this up sometime before. Okay. So you were talking about the Princess Nokia, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so, and I'm kind of regretting not putting this artist as my my underground
underdog.
My underdog. But the only reason I didn't is because they're not a rapper; it's just a straight producer. But it's funny that you bring that up. This is just a quick side note. So she made that video, right? Basically, you know, shooting her shots at Ariana Grande for biting her flow or whatever the case may be.
Right.
Yeah.
I don't know that Princess Nokia song. I don't think anyone here does.
I don't.
Okay, cool. So no. It's funny that she made that video because there's actually, and he's fairly big, but he's not mainstream. Signed. Yeah, he's not mainstream. He's not signed. He's mainly a producer. He makes a lot of remixes and things like that. But it's funny because whatever that Princess Nokia song was, apparently she stole, or I wouldn't even say stole, but there's a melody off of that Princess Nokia song from one of my favorite producers named Oshi. And it's funny. It's just, like I said, it's a side note. It's really funny the fact that
she's calling someone else on something that she basically did for the right. song that so she's like, calling him out on. Like, yeah. She's being a huge hypocrite is basically what you're
exactly.
saying.
That's exactly what I'm saying. So, like, Oshi made, like, a sample pack, basically, and it had, a bunch of melodies on it and things like that. Obviously, there was no, like, I don't believe he was selling it. It was kind of like a free royalty pack for people to just go and take and use it to their own expense. It's just really funny how hypocritical that video is, considering the melody that she's using that song for, like, that's made from a sample pack from a producer.
Mm-hmm.
But you failed to mention that.
Mm-hmm.
Two, you're going out of your way to shoot shots at Ariana Grande when you're kind of doing the same thing.
Well, so I just think the big thing is, especially in hip hop in general, people are influenced by their other artists in hip hop.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of like, oh, this sounds very similar to that, and this sounds very similar to this. Like,
yeah.
That's a known thing that's been happening to hip hop literally since it started. This isn't anything new to happen.
This isn't going
to
stop. It's not going to stop either.
But that's also what makes hip hop kind of great, is some of these artists are pulling what someone else did and making it better.
Oh.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Shout out Jack Queese for that.
Amia just pulled it up. She said the lyrics from Nokia's track are rock my mini styles, then go natural for the summer, hair blown in the Hummer. Flip the weave, I am a stunner. It's mine, I bought it. It's mine, I bought it.
That's Princess Nokia.
Yeah.
Yes.
Wow. That's I didn't know the bars were the same. The flow is definitely the same.
Yeah.
She twisted them.
Yeah. She flipped them, yeah.
So, I guess I can understand where she's coming from.
Yes, I get what she's...
She is being hypocritical.
Yeah,
but
yeah, for sure.
I can see.
But to me, this is one of those situations we're talking about, and that's a great line. It's not a bad line.
Yeah.
But the way Ariana Grande did it, it flowed a little bit better.
It did.
It was less syllables. Plus, it sounded better over a track.
Yeah, plus a lot of people don't really know who Princess Nokia is.
But that's one of the situations where, like, someone took some from the hip-hop community and made it better. Because in my opinion, number one, that's not bad. I like it. I actually, I listened to a snippet of this song when I saw this story. I was like, oh, did she really? Like, let me hear it.
Yeah.
And I heard that, and then I heard the way Ariana Grande did it, and I was like, it sounds smoother. With the way
it does, it does.
Which is, it's so sad, the fact that that's a thing. Like,
that's it's the not music gonna, industry as
that's,
a whole.
Yeah, that's just the way.
This even happens in country music.
Really?
Yeah, like people sound similar.
Actually,
all the time
why
in country
am I
music.
why am I surprised? I know I don't listen to country, but I know for a solid fact that that's like true. Like a lot of country music. Or at least
it sounds
me.
Similar. Like that's
well, yeah. You could say that about all music. Though.
That's the point I'm making. Is you could say that about all music. Like the top country artists all generally sound really different and all have their own styles. But as people are up and coming, you'll go, oh, they got that from this person.
You could look
and they
back,
got that from this person. But that's every music genre. Yeah. Like, this
you
is,
could look back at many generations
happens.
Too and be like, oh, this sounds like that or this. Sounds like, it just but it's like, just the music of time. Like people make shit that gets big and becomes popular, and people go, oh, I could do that, but maybe I can make it sound like this.
But
and,
I mean, the other thing is, like, you listen to, let's say, Eminem. He literally has a song where he lists his top five artists.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was it Till I Collapse? He lists his top five artists?
I don't know.
Oh, I'm not sure.
And he does say it's in no particular order. Jesus, I'm such a nerd.
Yep.
He says,
you stan Eminem.
Who's he say? He says, no, not just Eminem, just hip hop in general. But he says, Nas, Pac, Biggie, Andre. And I don't remember who the fifth is. But if you listen to Eminem, mm-hmm. and then even then, he'll tell you his favorite rapper is Redman. And you go listen to Redman back in the day, you can hear similarities between the two. Like, you can tell who people are influenced by.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, you listen to MGK, especially, like, his first album, you can see that he pulled a little bit from Eminem for some of those songs. Like,
so I guess the question would obviously be... You pull who you're influenced
by, and you end up sounding like them. Like, that's how the music industry works.
There's a very, very thin line.
So there is a very thin line for being influenced by someone and stealing from someone. Yeah. So, and the difference is how famous you are.
I think my favorite...
That's a shitty difference.
Yep. But think about it. When you're small and you pull from someone, it's, oh, I'm influenced by them. But the moment you're big and you sound like someone, it's they stole from me.
Example.
Not I inspired them. Was it? And that's the big difference is how famous you are and how much money you make in the music industry.
That is shitty.
Yep.
I don't like that.
It's the way it works.
Hey.
What's that one, for like an example, what's that one 90s rapper name? What's his name? Stole the beat from Queen and God, fuck. Ice. Huh? Vanilla Ice. Let's be for real.
What the fuck?
No. For
why are we talking about Vanilla Ice?
Because we're talking about...
I'm a Vanilla Ice like silicone.
We're talking about fluence from music. Influences from music. Let's be for real. I mean, he just stole. But let's be for real. I bet you if he didn't blow up, no one would have batted an eye about his beat.
No, because no one
would have cared.
As soon as he got big, motherfuckers are like, that sounds familiar. But even then, there's conspiracies about Queen even taking that from another song, wasn't it?
It happens all the time. There's situations in the music industry where people get sued for royalties on songs that the original song was recorded in like the 1920s. And they're like, oh, you stole this from me. And there's lawyers that make money off of that.
Yeah.
And the music labels are like, fuck off. We'll just give you a couple $1,000 to go suck a dick. Like, we don't care.
Yeah.
Like, this shit happens. Apparently, that happens a lot more than people realize. Because there's only so many variations of beats you can make. Like, it's on an 8-count.
Yeah.
There's so many different ways you could do an 8-count, and it's going to start sounding similar. So, there's always someone's song that's going to sound similar to yours. Yep. It's so hard to make it sound completely different. Especially now that, in today's day and age, with all this music that's out and coming out. Like, dude, there's no way you could... Yeah, you could be original, but you're not going to be completely original.
No.
Never.
It's impossible.
It's impossible.
But, you know, this... I think this is a good segment. I think we should go into the underdogs, bro.
All right.
Some more shit I got to talk about first.
We like an hour 50 in, bro.
That's fine.
Save it, bro. Save it.
Save it for the next one.
All right, we'll save it for the next one.
I'm not going to lie. Save it.
Who's underdog song's coming up first? You know...
Okay, so
you gotta... The underdog segment is a segment that we do where we decide to play music for people that we enjoy, that we think you should also listen to and enjoy, and they may not be people who you know or have ever heard of.
That's going to be false for me, for this one. Uh-oh. At least. That is 100% going to be false. He was, quote-unquote, an underdog at first. He has now since blown up.
Okay.
Fair enough.
So
I'm not going to lie. I changed songs last minute and forget what song I played.
Cool.
Or chose.
Let's fucking do this. So
is whose song is up first?
Joshua, I think it's you.
Okay.
Yep.
Nice.
And let's do this.
Out of cyber, out of mind, yeah. I can't lie, I'm detached, I need guidance. I've been dying. I've been fighting, got this voice in my mind, won't be quiet. Silent ride home, silent ride, silent ride home, silent ride, silent ride home. I got all these voices in my head, got too many bitches in my bed. I don't store the number, just instead I start scrolling through the text and look for pictures in the thread. I'm on your head, you only banging cause it's streaming, ain't you? You only gang when it's convenient,
So that's a little bit of Boogie off of his new album coming out. I'm here soon, like a week. I believe it's January 26th, I believe the album's coming out. That's the first single off of it, Silent Ride. This will be his first album released under Shady Records. I'd like to talk about a few of those lines right there, because some of those lines are tough, particularly towards the ones that we ended on.
Okay.
One of the ones he mentions is like, we don't say phone numbers out here. If I need to know who I'm talking to, I'll just scroll up through the photos and look at photos.
Ooh.
Like, that's some hard shit right there. You already know. You save them names, and your girl sees your phone.
Bet.
It's over.
That's a decent bar.
Yeah. Here, if you give me a second, I'll pull up the actual lyric for everybody. It's not what I need.
Gotta do that right now, Neil. You gotta do that right now, bro.
Been doing the whole fucking podcast.
Bro, we ain't been doing this for the whole two tests.
And you did not hear a piece of it.
Oh, okay. This shit's gonna show up.
So, this is the beginning part, which is what we played. We played the chorus, which is how the song starts. And then he says, I got all these voices in my head. You know, typical shit, you think it, right?
Yeah.
Got too many bitches in my bed, right? It's kind of hard. Then he goes, I don't store numbers, just instead, I start scrolling through text and look for pictures in the thread.
Ooh.
That's hard. That's hard. And then he says, I'm on your head, you're only banging because of streaming, ain't ya? You're only gang when it's convenient, ain't ya? And that's a hard bar, too. There's a lot of that shit in hip-hop where people are like, I'm a blood, I'm a crip, but only when it's convenient for him to do it to sell albums. And he calls that shit out right there, and he does it in such a good and smooth way. I highly recommend listening to that whole song. I highly recommend checking that album out.
What's that song called one more time?
Silent Ride.
Yeah.
Silent Ride. Music video's out on YouTube. Like I said, it's up his first official album. He's got a couple mixtapes out. The Thirst 48, Parts 1 and 2. Two of his mixtape out. Phenomenal mixtapes. Great. Talk about a homegirl named Jamisha. It's all about. He has assured us that this album is not about Jamisha, so we'll see how that goes. It's his first album released off Shady Records. I highly recommend checking it out. He's from Compton, by the way. He's a West Coast rapper.
Bet.
You can tell by the beat, though. You can tell by that beat. That's definitely a West Coast beat.
Bet. That beat, for sure.
That's like a 90s West Coast beat type of feel. I fuck with it.
For sure. So, you know, I heard we talking about some fire-ass lyrics. I thought I'd bring up some of my own real quick.
Huh?
Yeah.
Some of your own.
I mean.
Mm-hmm. Not mine, but, you know.
I mean.
Some lyrics I think are fire real quick.
Okay.
Yeah. Neil, this is for you, buddy. So you try to.
Oh, fuck.
I am concerned.
This is a good lyric. It says, you trying to be me, bitch, but you could never be in your life, even if you had all my sneakers like Bow Wow and like Mike. That's tough.
Why was that for me?
Yeah, who said that?
I think, if I remember correctly, Ski Master Slump God.
Why was that for me? That was a decent bar.
I'm not gonna lie. That Mike line was kind of nice.
That was a nice bar.
That was a good movie.
That's a tough.
I feel no way.
It still makes me laugh, though.
I got.
Fair enough.
I got techniques dripping out my butt cheeks. I sleep with my stomach, so I don't fuck up my sheets.
You're gonna say that every time.
Put my sauce on lasagna; it could make Garfield purr.
I'm sipping. Yeah. What is it? I'm sitting here sipping on Guinness, weighing 165, and you trick should die.
I hate you both.
Oh shit!
Hey, that's a Pac bar.
That is a Pac bar.
It's a Pac bar.
All right, so.
Sorry. Oh. Song started playing in my head, but I was getting into it.
I'm next.
I was about to spit.
Chill out. So up next is, I believe, is yours, Vince.
All right, bet.
Or not?
There we go.
You trying to step up to the three? Bring your ass to Tennessee. Shit's wild in the South. That's how these players came to be the most. At least faded, can't you motherfucker see? When you fucking with the devilish, it's rest in piss, you flee. Could give a fuck, I get bugged, drink a beer and smoke a blunt. I have no sense to care enough, I'm just doing what I love. Twist the butt and bring the funk, I ain't worried about a bitch. But if you step up to me, fuck, then I'ma show you what the biz. Kiss my motherfucking fist and bow down to this cryptic camp. Now you bitches got me pissed, so I'ma break y'all like this. Kill your brother, stick my dick off in your system.
to the three. Bring your ass to Tennessee. Fight his pile in the south. Oh, yeah. Saudis killers.
You, you should actually listen to Yellow. I'm telling you, you would fuck with him.
All right.
Got it. So that was the three by the Devilish Trio.
I like it.
So the only reason I picked that, well, first off, let me talk about the group. So the Devilish Trio is made of Baker Your Maker, Hydra, and 10 Gauge from Nashville, Tennessee. Yep. So,
yep.
I guess more or less the reason why I picked that, that's more up the lane of producing. If just for the viewers and people listening, like, I produce, so that's more of the lane I've been trying to get into as far as beats go. So that's more or less like the funk I was talking about. So P-H-O-N-K. Yeah, they're a dope ass group though. They're more like they have a very 3-6 Mafia vibe.
Yeah, I like that. I like that song a lot. I'm gonna check some of them out.
They have a very 3-6 Mafia vibe. But I fuck with them heavy. Like I said, that's the lane I've been trying to go up through as far as producing music. But yeah, check them out. It's off their album, The Collection.
Okay.
I like the beat, 100%. I thought it was a good beat. Fuck with it.
I like it just because it's a different lane in hip-hop that doesn't get explored much, and that is, like, that mm-hmm. Tennessee, that Southern,
yeah.
like,
yeah.
that little bit of twang in the voice. That doesn't get a whole lot of recognition, even though there's a lot of good rappers with that.
Yeah.
It doesn't get recognition because the nature of hip-hop is Atlanta and New York and Detroit.
It's funny that West you... Coast. It's funny that you say that, too, because a lot of... Well, let me not say a lot, but there's a few... There's, like, a couple songs out there right now by really, like, big-name artists that are starting to kind of vibe with the whole
mm-hmm.
funk sound. So, like, mm-hmm. I would say, like, an example would be... What's 21 Savage's first song on his newest album?
A Lot, the one with J. Cole?
So, like... Something like that. So, like, yeah. it's kind of a mix of trap beats, but there's a lot of 90s Memphis vocals behind it.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, a lot of rappers, big name artists, are trying to
kind of use it more, sample it a little
bit
more.
Yeah. And it hasn't been introduced enough for me to say how I feel on it, but I don't know how I feel on it, honestly, because it's like one of those things where, like, an artist, like, you don't want them to get too big to where everyone's listening to it.
No, I understand that entirely. Yeah,
but that's how I feel.
No, I get that. I completely understand that. Because you feel like if they get mainstream, it's going to take the magic away.
Yeah.
They're going to...
Or their sound could change.
Yeah, their sound could change because then they're going to want to cater towards what is more mainstream.
Yeah.
And I've actually seen that a lot with MGK. You listen to MGK's first album, entirely different than the next two.
Yeah,
I'm curious to see what he does for the third one, actually. Or but fourth one, I'm sorry.
But check them out, like I said. They're with this trio.
I liked it a lot. Like I said, I like the vibe that they have, too. Like that vibe at the beginning of that song. And like I said, that Southern twang, you don't hear a lot of it in hip-hop.
Yeah.
Yeehaw.
Shut the fuck up. I'm so fucking sick. No. You're from... I mean, technically, you from the South. All things considered, you from the South.
Yeah.
But if you're going to start saying yeehaw, you better start walking right here with a goddamn cowboy hat and some boots, bro. I want you to have some
belt.
Spurs.
I'm going
to
get a fucking belt, bitch.
Get a big-ass belt buckle, bro.
Ting, 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 you know what I'm saying?
Next time I got the gun show over at Hampton Coliseum, go to it. Pick yourself up a goddamn leather belt with a fat-ass belt buckle.
Bet.
You have a gun? Do you still have a gun?
Yes, you already asked that.
Might fuck around and kill myself.
Let's drink the Kool-Aid.
You gonna put that on the podcast, bro?
No, I'm just kidding.
Dude, what the fuck?
It's all jokes. I'm kidding.
Neil, are you okay? God. Do we need to have a discussion?
Dude, I've never been so happy. Like, hello, I'm good. 911. Everybody just chill out. Relax.
All right, well, on that note, my song's up next. So.
Fuck.
Shut up.
I've been in Arizona. Yeah. I felt
know this has been playing for a hot minute, but I at least want to get to where the actual artist comes. This is the feature. This is Arizona, but this is the actual artist now, actually.
You paused it.
I did not pause it. Uh-oh.
Transport through the land, searching for the desert sand. World tour, Jodeci, diary of a madman. 4 a.m. microdose, feeling like a madman. Don't want none of that, eyes on the game plan. Big haze, lemonade, mindset, Brian Kane. Misbehave, but I feel like easy beaming out the Milky Way. People try to stop me, but I'm sailing through the waves. I know, not yet in my feet, don't need to give a light show. People wonder where we're in the fuck is in, though. Staring at my screen, I need a fucking window. Yeah.
All right, so that is Rich Brian. Who is that featured again? I can't remember. That is Rich Brian featuring, his name is August 08. Honestly, I didn't find out about Rich Brian until probably he got actually really popular. Was his Dat Shtick song.
Oh, Lord.
Dat, you,
I do remember that.
Have you heard that?
Have you heard that song? Okay. Remember.
Yeah, so Dat Shtick is a funny-ass song. It's stupid as fuck. But a lot of people were like, his voice is definitely different than a lot of people you hear out there. And he, at the time, he was only 16 years old when he recorded that shit. And he sounded exactly like he does right now.
Yeah. His voice is very unique.
Like, and
no one has that voice.
Oh, yeah. No one has that voice. But yeah, I found him when a video of like a couple actual like popular rappers like saw this video. And they're like, oh, that shit tough. He's out here with like a fanny pack and shit like this. And like, before his name was Rich Brian, his name was actually Rich Chiga.
Which caught a lot of flack.
No, no.
Yeah, what?
Yeah. He was like, I know a lot of rap artists nowadays, you know, use the N-word in their songs and all that. He was like, so I thought I could incorporate it in my own way. So he said, I call myself Rich Chiga. But you know what's wild?
Wait, I have a question.
Okay.
Yes, he's Asian.
No, I was going to go deeper than that.
Okay, what's up?
Is he Chinese?
No.
Then that's fucked up and racist.
Is he?
No, I have no idea.
No, I don't think he is. He's
Yeah, that's wild though. That's a wild ass name, bro. I see why he changed it.
Yeah, he but you know, it was really funny is like most of the rap artists who even looked at his song, the people were like, yeah, his name's Rich Chiga, they all gave him 100% props from it.
And he's 100% walking around with a fanny pack.
Chinese,
like it's 1990 at Disneyland.
Okay, that was only off his first song that.
So he's from Indonesia. Okay, his ethnic is Chinese Indonesian.
So there we go. So it's not racist because he is Chinese.
But a lot of the rap artists gave him props. They're like Rich Chiga. They're like, we like that. That's tough.
Yeah, he's but trying to be his own thing.
A lot of people, he got flack for it because he was saying he made that up and try to quote unquote, if I remember correctly, it was from like a Guinness interview. In racism in his own way, he was like, I think it's dumb that, you know, because in that song he even drops the N-word a couple times, and he does, yeah, and
they, like,
okay. Why'd you look at me for confirmation?
I haven't heard the song. I don't remember the song.
So he was like, yeah, I'm just doing this. He was like, I think it's whack.
That reminds me of Nems. People give Nems a lot of flack because he's Puerto Rican and he drops the N-word a lot in his music.
Yeah, but he changed his name to Rich Brian. He was like, he realized that he fucked up. He was like, he was younger. He was like, so he changed it and he dropped his album A Man in 2018. Shit blew the fuck up. And I think a lot of the songs on there are actually really fucking good. There were a couple bops. And then
we gotta come up with a different term than that.
What, bops?
Bops?
Yeah, I don't like that term.
Okay, some of them were hits. Is that better?
That might be why I don't like it.
Yeah, no, it's annoying. But then after that, he...
Like, whatever happened to Banger? Like, is that gone now? Can we not say that's a banger anymore?
Yes, friend, that's gone.
So we got to call it a bop? No, I'm not rolling with that. I don't like
okay,
it.
Okay, good for you. But yeah.
For those who didn't... Time out. Hold, okay. For those who didn't hear that, Amia just said...
Kanye me?
Yes. Wow. Shut the fuck up.
All right.
Amia just said, that's a knee-slapping bop. That's Yeehaw. Why I don't like calling things bops, because that right there, it sounds
it's annoying.
Too normal. Like, a knee slapping followed by bop sounds like it fits too well.
It's too white.
For me to talk about it's too white, music.
It's too normal.
It sounds too normal. Like, those two things, knee slapping shouldn't be followed by anything and sound okay.
Like bop.
And it just, it sounds like it fits, and I don't like it.
Uh-huh. But yeah, you guys should check him out. He was technically what you would quote call an underdog way back when, but he's since
way blew back up. When last year is not exactly way back when.
No, he was releasing music like 2 years ago. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, he was, I mean, kind of fair,
that like, stick came out in like 2016.
What's his public Spotify? What's his numbers?
Okay.
Like his top five songs, what numbers is he getting?
Since he blew up, which is what I was trying to get to, and I know I was over talking, he signed up with 88 Rising, dropped Amen under that, and then dropped a collab album with 88 Rising with all of their people. I think it was called Summer Something. It was like a summer album.
I just want you to go to his Spotify account and pull up his top five songs. Like, what are the streaming numbers on just Spotify alone?
Let me pull that up on my phone.
I got it.
Because his top song right now is Midsummer Madness, if I remember correctly.
Maybe. Oh yeah, this man is not underground anymore.
Yeah, almost 100 mil.
Like, he's got 66 mil, 27 mil, 92 mil, 99 mil, and 16 mil. Yeah. Compared to, like, the person I play, Boogie, like, his top is, like, 5 mil, 6 mil, and then 2 mil, and then, like, 500,000. So I was just trying to put in perspective for the people listening, like, where his level of success is.
Yeah, he has 4 million
monthly listeners. And I would say that's he's obtained a solid level of success already for this point in his career.
It's so wild for him because he was like, it just happened overnight. He's like, literally one morning I just woke up and like shit.
Like, okay, but to be fair, it may come off as overnight, but you say he's been making music for what, 2 years?
He's been dropping just like dumb songs every once in a while, yeah.
Like for 2 years, like, that's not exactly overnight. It may come off as overnight because to him it felt like he may have went from 1,000 listeners to 1,000,000 listeners in like the course of one song, but he was still putting a lot of work into that before that. So I don't know if I could.
What happened is that shtick, I think 2016 was his first song he ever released and was actually put on Spotify. That's the one that blew him up, but he was probably he was 100% in my opinion at Boogie's level. He was over here making 9-10 million plays, because that's when I looked him up.
Say Boogie's not even hitting
way before
9 million on Spotify.
Way before Amen drop, I looked him up on Spotify, and each of his singles that he dropped had at least 9+ million views.
I mean, that's like,
but ever since he dropped, I think it was a single. It was Glow Like That, a single that he dropped for the album Amen. Blew up, and then he dropped another single with Christ with 21 Savage. He definitely, that's when it started happening. And next, you know, talk about an album coming out 2018 with this new record label called 88 Rising.
He started to get, well, before the record label, obviously, he was getting like some serious features.
Yeah,
so
okay. You said the record label is 88 Rising.
Mm-hmm. They have the collab album Midsummer Madness, I think, is the single he's known for. I don't remember the actual album, but you know Joji? You guys know Joji, right?
Yeah.
Sounds familiar.
He's under 88 Rising, a.k.a. Filthy Frank. Motherfucker used to just make dumbass YouTube videos. All of a sudden made another, what he would call, like, a personality. And he blew up too, man. He was just a literal overnight sensation because he used to do dumb rap music under the name Pink Guy. And he just released something under Joji, and I shit you not, I heard about it, and it was on SoundCloud and all that shit. Next thing you know, this shit was on Spotify. And I was like, hello? I was like, and it was millions and millions of plays. Like, he just, out of nowhere, and now that's all he does. Which, I mean, good for him. He got out of YouTube in time, in my opinion. Because what he used to do, ain't no way that shit would be allowed now at all.
For sure.
But yeah, man. I know he's not, you know, super underground, but yeah, name of the album by 88 Rising is Head in the Clouds. It's got people like Joji, Nicki, Young Bands.
I actually have a question, and this is probably far off. Do you know who Keith Ape is, and is he on 88 Rising? And I'm
yes, he is. I just saw that he is.
I knew it. I had to have known. Okay, so the reason why I asked that is because
Playboi Carti's under 88 Rising.
That's interesting.
I think. Right.
Not. I don't think he is.
He was a feature on their album then.
He may be a feature on album, but he's not on the record label.
But I kind of wildly guessed. Well, it was more of an educated guess, but the only reason I asked is because I know, or at least I'm assuming, 88 Rising is like a record label. It's kind of filled with a lot of Asian rappers. Keith Ape is one of them. If I play I'm not going to play a song right now. We're running low on time, but there's a song that was like really dope, and I want to play it for you guys after this whole podcast is over.
I'm down.
But I want to see if you guys remember the song at all.
Okay.
I guess I did just look up the record label because I was curious. 88 Rising. I wanted to see where they were. They were founded 4 years ago, initially under the name Cash Only, and then they changed their name to 88 Rising. Which, by the way, that's a weird name for a record label because I don't know only? If y'all know this. No, or no, no. 88. 88 Rising. Because 88 is a big number in Nazi Germany.
Uh-oh.
88 means Hail Hitler. Because 8 H is the 8th letter in the alphabet. So
I don't think
Nazi Germany. Like I don't think they are. I'm just saying, like, that's might be something they want to look into. Might go back to Cash Only. You know what I'm saying? But, no, the main reason why I looked them up, I wanted to see if they had a parent company. They do not. They are independent. They were not owned by Atlantic. They're not a sub record label. So, I really want to know their deals with this label because I want to know if they have 360 deals.
Maybe.
I want to know if this small record label was giving 360 deals for these artists because that could be a big deal.
I don't think they were.
I don't think they did.
No.
I don't think they would have.
Yeah, I don't think so either.
From what it looks like.
But I'm still curious.
Yeah, fair enough.
But, yeah, that was my song choice.
Yeah, they should change the name.
But, I think that's all the time we have. Do you guys have anything else before we end this?
No, I think I'm going to save any other topics I may or may not have for the next podcast.
Yeah, the Capitals just lost a hockey game 8-5. Listen, how you give up 8 goddamn goals? Who the fuck was playing goalie?
Good night, y'all.
The cubicle is clocking out.